Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The First American by H.W. Brands. Narrated by Nelson Runger. This work is copyrighted 2000 by H.W. Brands. This recording is copyrighted 2001 by Recorded Books. In the first comprehensive biography of Benjamin Franklin in over 60 years, acclaimed historian H.W. Brands brings vividly to life one of the most delightful, bawdy, brilliant, original, and important figures in American history. And now, The First American, Part 1.
Prologue, January 29th, 1774. A lesser man would have been humiliated. Humiliation was the purpose of the proceeding. It was the outcome eagerly anticipated by the lords of the Privy Council who constituted the official audience, by the members of the House of Commons and other fashionable Londoners who packed the room and hung on the rails of the balcony, by the London press that lived on scandal and milled outside to see how this scandal would unfold, by the throngs that bought the papers, savored the scandals, rioted in favor of their heroes and against their villains, and made politics in the British imperial capital often unpredictable, frequently disreputable, always entertaining. The proceeding today would probably be disreputable. It would certainly be entertaining. The venue was fitting, the cockpit. In the reign of Henry VIII, that most sporting of monarchs in a land that loved its bloody games, the building on this site had housed an actual cockpit, where Henry and his friends brought their prize birds and wagered which would tear the others to shreds. The present building had replaced the real cockpit, but this room retained the old name and atmosphere. The victim today was expected to depart with his reputation in tatters, his fortune possibly forfeit, his life conceivably at peril. Nor was that the extent of the stakes. 2 days earlier, the December packet ship from Boston had arrived with an alarming report from the royal governor of Massachusetts, Thomas Hutchinson. The governor described an organized assault on 3 British vessels carrying tea of the East India Company. The assailants, townsmen loosely disguised as Indians, had boarded the ships, hauled hundreds of tea casks to deck, smashed them open, and dumped their contents into the harbor. 45 tons of tea, enough to litter the beaches for miles and depress the company's profits for years. This rampage was the latest in a series of violent outbursts against the authority of Crown and Parliament. The audience in the cockpit, and in London beyond, demanded to know what Crown and Parliament intended to do about it. Alexander Wedderburn was going to tell them. The Solicitor General possessed great rhetorical gifts and greater ambition. The former had made him the most feared advocate in the realm. The latter lifted him to his present post when he abandoned his allies in the opposition and embraced the ministry of Lord North. Wedderburn was known to consider the Boston Tea Riot treason, and if the law courts upheld his interpretation, those behind the riot would be liable to the most severe sanctions, potentially including death. Wedderburn was expected to argue that the man in the cockpit today was the prime mover behind the outburst in Boston. The crowd quivered with anticipation. They all knew the man in the pit. Indeed, the whole world knew Benjamin Franklin. His work as political agent for several of the American colonies had earned him recognition around London, but his fame far transcended that. He was quite simply one of the most illustrious scientists and thinkers on earth. his experiments with electricity, culminating in his capture of lightning from the heavens, had won him universal praise as the modern Prometheus. His mapping of the Gulf Stream saved the time and lives of countless sailors. His ingenious fireplace conserved fuel and warmed homes on both sides of the Atlantic. His contributions to economics, meteorology, music, and psychology expanded the reach of human knowledge and the grip of human power. For his accomplishments, the British Royal Society had awarded him its highest prize. Foreign societies had done the same. Universities queued to grant him degrees. The ablest minds of the age consulted him on matters large and small. Kings and emperors summoned him to court, where they admired his brilliance and basked in its reflected glory. Genius is prone to producing envy. Yet it was part of Franklin's genius that he had produced far less than his share, due to an unusual ability to disarm those disposed to envy. In youth, he discovered that he was quicker of mind and more facile of pen than almost everyone he met. He also discovered that a boy of humble birth, no matter how gifted, would block his own way by letting on that he knew how smart he was. He learned to deflect credit for some of his most important innovations. He avoided arguments wherever possible. When important public issues hinged on others being convinced of their errors, he often argued anonymously, adopting assumed names, or Socratically, employing the gentle questioning of the Greek master. He became almost as famous for his sense of humor as for his science. Laughing, his opponents listened and were persuaded. Franklin's self-effacing style succeeded remarkably. At 68, he had almost no personal enemies and comparatively few political enemies for a man of public affairs. But those few included powerful figures. George Grenville, the Prime Minister responsible for the Stamp Act, the tax bill that triggered all the American troubles, never forgave him for single-handedly demolishing the rationale for the act in a memorable session before the House of Commons. Grenville and his allies lay in wait to exact their revenge on Franklin. Yet, he never made a false step. Until now. A mysterious person had delivered into his hands confidential letters from Governor Hutchinson and other royal officials in Massachusetts addressed to an Undersecretary of State in London. These letters cast grave doubt on the bona fides of Hutchinson, for years the bête noire of the Massachusetts Assembly. As Massachusetts's agent, Franklin had forwarded the letters to friends in Boston. Hutchinson's enemies there got hold of the letters and published them. The publication provoked an instant uproar. In America, the letters were interpreted as part of a British plot to enslave the colonies. The letters fueled the anger that inspired the violence that produced the Boston Tea Riot. In England, the letters provoked charges and countercharges as to who could have been so dishonorable as to steal and publish private correspondence. A duel at swords left one party wounded and both parties aching for further satisfaction. Only at this point, to prevent more bloodshed, did Franklin reveal his role in transmitting the letters. His foes seized the chance to destroy him. Since that session in Commons 8 years before, he had become the symbol and spokesman in London of American resistance to the sovereignty of Parliament. On his head would be visited all the wrath and resentment that had been building in that proud institution from the time of the Stamp Act to the Tea Riot. Alexander Wedderburn sharpened his tongue and moved in for the kill. None present at the cockpit on January 29, 1774, could afterward recall the like of the hearing that day. The Solicitor General outdid himself. For an hour he hurled invective at Franklin, branding him a liar, a thief, the instigator of the insurrection in Massachusetts, an outcast from the company of all honest men, an ingrate whose attack on Hutchinson betrayed nothing less than a desire to seize the governor's office for himself. So slanderous was Wedderburn's diatribe that no London paper would print it. But the audience reveled in it, hooting and applauding each sally, each bilious bon mot. Not even the lords of the Privy Council attempted to disguise their delight at Wedderburn's astonishing attack. Almost to a man and a woman, the spectators that day concluded that Franklin's reputation would never recover. Ignominy, if not prison or worse, was his future now. Franklin stood silent throughout his ordeal. Even at his advanced age, he was a large man, taller than most people would have guessed. His shoulders had lost some of their youthful breadth, for it had been decades since he hoisted the heavy sets of lead type that were the printer's daily burden, and longer since he had swum for exercise. But still, they conveyed an impression of strength. His stoutness had increased with the years. Cloaked today in a brown, knee-length coat of Manchester velvet, it connoted gravity. He eschewed the wigs that decorated nearly every head present, male and female. His thin gray hair fell over and behind his ears to his shoulders. His face had never been expressive. Today, it was a mask. Not the slightest frown or grimace greeted the diatribes rained down upon him. When instructed to submit to questions, he silently refused, a refusal that seemed to seal his humiliation. But he was not humiliated. He was outraged. The mask concealed not mortification, but anger. Who did these people, this bought solicitor, these smug lords, the corrupt ministers that made the proceeding possible, who did they think they were? Who did they think he was? It was the question of the hour. Generalized, it was the question on which hung the fate of the British Empire. Who were these Americans? To the British, they were Britons, albeit of a turbulent sort. The Americans might live across the ocean, but the colonies they inhabited had been planted by Britain and were defended by Britain. Therefore, to the government of Britain, preeminently to the British Parliament, the Americans must submit, like any other Britons. To the Americans, the question was more complicated. Nearly all Americans considered themselves Britons, but Britons of a different kind than lived in London or the Midlands or Scotland. Possessing their own assemblies, their own parliaments, the Americans believed they answered to the British Crown, but not to the British Parliament. At its core, the struggle between the American colonies and the British government was a contest between these competing definitions of American identity. Put simply, were the Americans truly Britons, or were they something else? Franklin came to the questioning with decades of experience. For his whole life, he had been asking himself who or what he was. As a boy, he had been a Bostonian. Yet the theocratic orthodoxy of Boston's Puritans eventually became more than he could stand, and linked to the legal and familial orthodoxy of an apprenticeship to an overbearing elder brother, it drove him away. He broke his apprenticeship, defied law and family, and fled Boston. He landed in Philadelphia, a comparative haven for free thinkers like himself. During the next 40 years, he earned an honorable name and substantial wealth as the publisher of the Pennsylvania Gazette, the author of Poor Richard's Almanac, and the originator of numerous public improvements in his adopted home. By all evidence, he was the model Philadelphian. Yet, gradually, Philadelphia, like Boston before it, began to chafe. The political framework that had suited Pennsylvania at its founding, the charter granted by Charles II to William Penn and his heirs, hindered the growth of the province at maturity. For his first two decades in Philadelphia, Franklin scarcely noticed politics. But the wars that accompanied colonial life during the 18th century enforced attention. And they drove home the anachronistic nature of rule by a single family. Initially, he battled the Penns from Philadelphia. When that failed, he carried the fight to England as the agent of the Pennsylvania Assembly. Yet there was more than politics in his departure. Like Boston before it, Philadelphia had become too small for him. The budding genius of his Boston youth had blossomed in the tolerant atmosphere of Philadelphia. But Philadelphia, and finally even all of America, afforded insufficient scope for the talents he discovered in himself and the world discovered in him. Kindred scientific spirits were few in America. Kindred intellectual gifts still fewer. Britain, at first, seemed everything Franklin desired. Electricians and others who had admired him from afar found him even more admirable in person. His admirers became his friends became his sponsors, introducing him to influential figures throughout the country. His journeys across England and Scotland turned into triumphal processions. The best houses opened their doors to him. Cities and towns made him an honorary citizen. The Royal Society embraced him and provided a venue through which he communicated with the most learned and ingenious men of Britain and Europe. The Scotsman Hume, the Irishman Burke, the German Kant, the Italian Beccaria, the Frenchman Condorcet. London was soon his spiritual home. It would have been his actual and permanent home if he had succeeded in persuading his wife, Deborah, to leave Philadelphia. As it was, despite her refusal, he took up semi-permanent residence in London, in Craven Street. Franklin proudly called himself a Briton. In doing so, he didn't deny his American birth, for he conceived Americans to be as fully Britons as the English, Scots, and Welsh. He delineated for all who would listen the glorious future of Britain in North America, a future joining American energy to the English tradition of self-government. As a measure of his faith in the future of America within the British Empire, he employed his influence to help his son William win appointment as Royal Governor of New Jersey. But then things began to go wrong. A foolish ministry ignored that tradition of self-government and started treating the Americans as subjects, not subjects simply of King George, but of Parliament. The Stamp Act attempted to put this novel interpretation into effect and touched off the first round of rioting in America. Franklin sought to calm the turmoil by persuading Parliament of its error. This was the purpose of his appearance before Commons in 1766. Yet, though the Grenvillites were compelled to retreat at that time, the lesson never took hold, and distrust between the colonies and the mother country grew. All the same, for several years, civil discussions of the differences between the American and British views of the English Constitution remained possible. Franklin, the most civil of men, did his best to promote these discussions, at peril to his political reputation in America, where the radicals spoke of him as residing in the pocket of the British ministry. And what had his efforts accomplished? The answer came in the cockpit. Nothing but abuse and condemnation from an arrogant people maliciously led. Wedderburn and the ministry ignored the crucial issues between Britain and America, the high constitutional questions that would hold the empire together or tear it apart, in order to indulge personal vanity and satisfy corrupt ambition. At this moment of truth, all the British government could do was vilify the character of one who had been Britain's most loyal subject, its best friend among the Americans. Franklin had thought Britain could be his home. Now he realized his only home was America. In the cockpit, it was Wedderburn insulting Franklin, but it was also Britain mocking America. Franklin left the cockpit seething, yet enlightened. Wedderburn had answered the question that Franklin had been asking all his life, and that his fellow Americans had been asking of late. Who were they? They must be Americans, for they could not be Britons. Revolutions are not made in a morning, nor empires lost in a day. But Britain did itself more damage in those 2 hours than anyone present imagined. By alienating Franklin, the British government showed itself doubly inept. For making an enemy of a friend, and for doing so of the ablest and most respected American alive. At a moment when independence was hardly dreamed of in America, Franklin understood that to independence, America must come. He sailed for home, his real home, still burning with anger and disgust, and immediately took a place at the head of the opposition to British rule. Once the most loyal of Britons, now he became the most radical of Americans, demanding independence and driving the rebellion to a genuine revolution. He helped draft the Declaration of Independence. When that manifesto of American identity won the approval of the Continental Congress, he helped organize the government of the new republic. He guided American diplomatic efforts and sent secret American agents to Europe. Traveling to Paris himself, he negotiated the treaty with Britain's nemesis, France, that gave the revolution its first real hope of success. From Paris, he directed the American war effort abroad, securing the gifts and loans that kept American soldiers in the field and managing the system of alliances that finally delivered America's freedom. In the eyes of much of Europe, Franklin was America. And the enormous respect accorded Franklin extrapolated to the American cause. Of those patriots who made independence possible, none mattered more than Franklin, and only Washington mattered as much. Washington won the Battle of Yorktown, but Franklin won the European support that allowed Washington his victory. At war's end, Franklin artfully headed negotiation of the peace settlement that guaranteed America's future by doubling the American domain and tying the interests of the European powers to America's continued success. Returning in triumph to Philadelphia, he was elected president of Pennsylvania, and in that capacity hosted the Constitutional Convention of 1787. Throughout the convention, he offered sage advice, keeping the delegates at their tasks when attention wandered, proposing the essential compromises that made the final consensus possible. As the sun set on his own life, he had the unparalleled pleasure of watching it rise on the life of the new American nation. Franklin's story is the story of a man, an exceedingly gifted man and a most engaging one. It's also the story of the birth of America. An America this man discovered in himself, then helped create in the world at large. Chapter 1. Boston Beginnings. 1706-1723. Cotton Mather was the pride of New England Puritanism. As a boy, he had shown a curious, inquiring mind. He studied science toward a career in medicine. But the pull of religion was too strong, as might have been expected of the grandson of Puritan pillars John Cotton and Richard Mather, and the son of Increase Mather, a column of Congregationalism of comparable diameter. Shortly after ordination in 1685, Cotton Mather joined his father at Boston's Second Church and commenced an astonishingly prolific career as a publicist of Puritanism. Some 450 books and pamphlets poured from his pen during his lifetime. Although the majority dealt with religious topics, many revealed a continuing affinity for such secular subjects as natural history and music. But nothing was truly secular for Cotton Mather. An unchurched neighbor fell from a rooftop and for weeks lay in a coma. Mather remembered having told the man that if he didn't get religion soon, God would lay him low. Coming to himself, Mather recorded in his diary, one of the first things he thought on was what I had said unto him, under the sense whereof he quickly went and joined himself unto the South Church, which, perhaps significantly, was not Mather's church. On another occasion, an even more mundane matter prompted musings on man's place in God's order. I was once emptying the cistern of nature and making water at the wall. At the same time, there came a dog who did so too before me. Thought I, what mean and vile things are the children of men in this mortal state? How much do our natural necessities abase us and place us in some regard on the same level with the very dogs? Additional reflection inspired a determination to transcend the gutter in which men's bodies were consigned to live. My thought proceeded, yet I will be a more noble creature, and at the very time when my natural necessities debase me into the condition of the beast, my spirit shall, I say, at that very time, rise and soar and fly up towards the employment of the angel. Never again, Mather vowed, would he answer the call of nature without consciously evoking some holy, noble, divine thought. Looking back on the matter later, he was happy to report, and I have done according to this resolution. With his Puritan contemporaries, Mather perceived the cosmos as a battleground between good and evil. God led the army of good, whose ranks included those humans his grace had inspired with biblically enlightened reason. Satan spearheaded the legions of evil, which counted unbridled passion and unrelieved ignorance among their principal weapons. To Mather and his fellow Puritans, God was a pervasive and all but tangible presence. Satan, still more so. That there is a devil is a thing doubted by none but such as are under the influence of the devil, Mather declared. Not only was Satan real, but he was actively involved in people's lives. The devil, in the prosecution and execution of his wrath upon them, often gets a liberty to make a descent upon the children of men. And nowhere was this more true than in New England, which the evil one had all to himself and his red children, the Tawnies, until lately, when the arrival of the Christian gospel had roused him to terrible anger. I believe there never was a poor plantation more pursued by the wrath of the devil than our poor New England. Mather rarely indulged in idle scribbling. Although weary readers of those 450 titles might have been forgiven for occasionally thinking so. At the time that he inscribed these words, Massachusetts was writhing under what seemed Satan's latest assault. The Salem witch trials of 1692 convulsed the colony as nothing before or after. No man or woman of consequence doubted that witches existed. Satan, according to the consensus, frequently acted through individuals who entered into demonic pacts with him. The only question was whether the 19 people executed were actually the demonic agents they were alleged to be by their accusers, principally teenage girls given to an unsettling emotionalism. Cotton Mather's attitude toward the accusations and the accused was typical, for him and for his time and place. The devil, exhibiting himself ordinarily as a small black man, has decoyed a fearful knot of proud, froward, ignorant, envious, and malicious creatures to list themselves in his horrid service by entering their names in a book by him tendered unto them. These witches, whereof above a score have now confessed and shown their deeds, and some are now tormented by the devils for confessing, have met in hellish rendezvouses, wherein the confessors do say they have had their diabolical sacraments, imitating the baptism and supper of our Lord. The witches laid hold of innocent men and women and carried them out of their houses, over trees and hills for miles through the air. They seize poor people about the country with various and bloody torments. And of those evidently preternatural torments, there are some have died. The people thus afflicted are miserably scratched and bitten, so that the marks are most visible to all the world, but the causes utterly invisible. And the same invisible furies do most visibly stick pins into the bodies of the afflicted, and scald them, and hideously distort and disjoint all their members, besides a thousand other sorts of plagues, beyond these of any natural diseases which they give unto them. With such awesome evil abroad in the land, Mather could only endorse the action of the Salem court that condemned the witches to death. Indeed, at one hanging, he all but tied the noose himself. The condemned man, pleading innocence, recited the Lord's Prayer in a powerful and moving voice. A wave of sympathy surged through the gathered throng, which reasoned that the devil would never suffer one of his servants to turn coat at the very gate of hell. But Mather stood against the tide, reminding the crowd that the evil one was never so dangerous as when he took on the trappings of righteousness. The merciful mood passed, and the rope snapped taut. Yet even Mather began to worry about the nature of some of the evidence accepted by the court. This spectral evidence consisted of statements by the accusers that they had seen the fiendish specters of the accused performing satanic acts. Mather did not doubt the veracity of many such statements. Certainly, the devil frequently incited his agents to such acts. But might his catalogue of destruction not also include planting false evidence in unwary and weakened minds, thereby engineering the conviction of innocent people, good and upstanding people, people like Mather himself even? Mather believed that his name ranked high on Satan's roster of enemies. He constantly ascribed diabolical intervention to the mishaps of his life. The manuscript of a particularly potent sermon disappeared on the eve of delivery. Mather concluded that the devil had stolen it. It turned up afterward. Mather interpreted the return as satanic taunting. Mather did not deem it beyond the evil one in his current ferocious descent upon Massachusetts to try to bring down a formidable foe like himself by conjuring spectral evidence pointing his way. He suggested that Satan and his fellow fallen angels had obtained the power to take on them the likeness of harmless people. He reiterated, Many innocent, yea, and some virtuous persons are by the devils in this matter imposed upon. It was this fear in Mather, shared among other ministers and magistrates of the district, that eventually brought the witch hunt to a halt. To accept spectral evidence was to hand enormous power to people who might be the devil's tools, which was to say to the devil himself. After worried reconsideration, the court threw out uncorroborated spectral evidence, and after the specters were barred from the court, other evidence evaporated. The hysteria waned. In time, some of those at the center of the proceedings regretted their actions. 5 years after the fact, Judge Samuel Sewell stood up before his fellows in the congregation at Boston South Church and acknowledged the blame and shame of his role in the witch trials. He requested the congregation's forgiveness and their prayers on his behalf for God's mercy. Cotton Mather did not go so far as a public recanting, but he later conceded, speaking of the man whose death he had guaranteed by his gallows intervention, that he wished he had never encountered the first letters of his name. Josiah Franklin almost certainly heard Samuel Sewell's confession on that January day in 1697. Josiah was a member of the South Church, also called the Third Church, being the third congregation established in Boston, and a friend of Sewell. Neither the friendship nor the membership was of especially long standing, for Josiah was a comparative newcomer to New England. In Old England, the Franklin family had lived in Ecton in Northamptonshire for at least 300 years, where they may have known the forebears of George Washington, whose ancestry also ran to that county. The Franklin family held a farm of 30 acres. In addition, the eldest son of each generation inherited and operated the family blacksmith shop. Josiah, being the fourth surviving son of his father Thomas Franklin, inherited neither farm nor smithy. And when the older man retired and went to live with Josiah's elder brother, Thomas's second adult son, John, in Banbury, Oxfordshire, Josiah accompanied him. John had solved the younger son problem by taking up dyeing. It was in this occupation that Thomas apprenticed Josiah to him. Josiah learned the trade well, and might have remained a dyer and an Englishman of the Midlands for the rest of his life, had not Charles II turned the Church of England in a popish direction Josiah's dissenting conscience couldn't abide. Josiah was not a confrontational type, and having acquired a wife, Anne, and 3 children, he felt the responsibilities of family. But ultimately he determined that England was unsafe for dissent, and he followed the thousands of nonconformists who had decamped to America before him. He arrived in Boston in 1683. As expected, he found the theology of his new home congenial, and after some asking around and sampling of sermons, he applied to join the South Church. Attaining full membership would take several years, but with eternity at issue, he was in no hurry. The economics of the move were more jarring. Boston was a small town and already had as many dyers as it could support. Consequently, Josiah had to find a new occupation. More soundings directed him to the chandler trade, that of making candles and soap. The business was always hard, often hot, although in winter this aspect was not unwelcome, frequently smelly. The primary raw material of both candles and soap was tallow rendered from animal carcasses. But it afforded a regular income to those unafraid to work, and being labor-intensive, it furnished early employment for as many children as came along. It also brought Josiah into contact with a broad spectrum of the inhabitants of his new home. All but the most slovenly needed soap. Only the poorest made do without candles. In time, Josiah won a contract to furnish candles for the night watch of the town, a concession that provided both a nice profit and additional access to community leaders. By all evidence, Josiah was a man of solid character, robust intelligence, and natural good judgment. The demands of his business kept him from taking public office, but his neighbors often sought his counsel on matters civic and personal. "I remember well," Benjamin Franklin recollected later, "his being frequently visited by leading people, who consulted him for his opinion in affairs of the town or of the church he belonged to, and showed a good deal of respect for his judgment and advice. He was also much consulted by private persons about their affairs when any difficulty occurred, and frequently chosen an arbitrator between contending parties." Josiah had additional gifts. Though not tall, he was well-built and strong. His hard work agreed with him. Until his death at 87, he lost scarcely a day to illness. He wrote in a confident hand, and according to his son, could draw prettily. Lacking formal training in music, he cultivated his native musicality himself. When he played psalm tunes on his violin and sung withal, as he sometimes did in an evening after the business of the day was over, it was extremely agreeable to hear. It may have been that voice that first attracted Abiah Folger, sitting a few rows from Josiah and Anne in the South Church. Abiah was the daughter of Peter Folger, who had emigrated to Massachusetts in 1635 in the first wave of Puritan refugees from Charles I and Bishop Laud, and on the same ship as the son of Governor John Winthrop. Peter Folger, 18 years of age on arrival, grew up with the new land, albeit restively. From Boston, he went straight upriver to Dedham. At 25, he joined an expedition to establish a new settlement on Martha's Vineyard. He subsequently moved to Nantucket, in part because the Puritan theocracy of Boston sat about as uncomfortably on his shoulders as had the Anglican authoritarianism of Charles and Laud. But he got along barely better with the representatives of Governor Edmund Andros of New York, the colony that claimed jurisdiction over Nantucket. In his position as clerk of the court, adjudicating a dispute among settlers of the island, Folger refused to release records that presumably would have supported the position favored by the governor. For his refusal, he was arrested and imprisoned. "In a place where never any Englishman was put," he complained in a petition to Andros, "and where the neighbor's hogs had laid but the night before, and in a bitter cold frost and deep snow." While Folger managed to defeat this prosecution, the experience only confirmed his disdain for authority. He became a Baptist. He took the side of local Indians against English encroachment. When the Indians forcibly resisted, he castigated colonial officials in a searing diatribe that he set to verse and sold in pamphlet in the heart of the enemy camp, Boston. While not in custody, Folger was equally busy at home. He and his wife Mary had 9 children, of whom Abiah was the last. Despite her father's distaste for entrenched power, she moved to Boston as a young adult. There she met Josiah and Anne Franklin, who welcomed her into communion with their church. When Anne died in 1689, bearing Josiah's 7th child, the father, after the practical if unromantic fashion of the age, wasted little time mourning her. Within 6 months, he was married to Abiah. He was 32. She was 10 years younger. Josiah and Abiah had 10 children together. 9 of these 10 survived childhood. One, Ebenezer, accidentally slipped under the surface of a soapy washtub at 16 months and was missed, too late to be revived. Benjamin, who was named for his father's next older and favorite brother, was the 8th child of his mother and the 15th of his father. He was born on January 6th, 1705, by the calendar then in use. This would translate to January 17th, 1706, when the calendar was reformed halfway through his life. His birthplace was the small house his parents were leasing on Milk Street, just across from the South Church. The convenience of the location, coupled with the fact that the birth occurred early on a Sunday, when the congregation would be in church anyway, prompted Josiah to swaddle the newborn in thick blankets against the January wind and carry him across the street for baptism within hours of the birth. The father returned the baby to the Milk Street house immediately after the christening. There, Ben lived for the next 6 years, until Josiah purchased a larger dwelling at the corner of Union and Hanover Streets. Even the larger house overflowed with all those children. The number actually in residence varied as the older ones came and went. Ben later recollected sitting down at the dinner table with an even dozen of his siblings. Other relatives, including Uncle Benjamin, spent stretches of various length under Josiah's roof. As one of the youngest, Ben necessarily learned to get along with others. Outnumbered and outweighed by his elder siblings, he relied on wits where force failed. Often, insight came after the fact. "When I was a child of 7 years old," he recounted several decades later, "my friends on a holiday filled my little pocket with halfpence. I went directly to a shop where they sold toys for children, and being charmed with the sound of a whistle that I met, by the way, in the hands of another boy, I voluntarily offered and gave all my money for it. When I came home, whistling all over the house, much pleased with my whistle, but disturbing all the family, my brothers, sisters, and cousins, understanding the bargain I had made, told me I had given 4 times as much for it as it was worth. Put me in mind of what good things I might have bought with the rest of the money, and laughed at me so much for my folly that I cried with vexation. And the reflection gave me more chagrin than the whistle gave me pleasure." With the wisdom of age, Franklin added, "As I came into the world and observed the actions of men, I thought I met many who gave too much for the whistle." Ben's facility with the written word manifested itself early. "I do not remember when I could not read," he said afterward, which in another person might have meant a weak memory, but in his case indicated real precociousness. This inclined his father to train him for the ministry, as did the circumstance that Ben was the 10th, the tithe, of Josiah's sons. At 8 years, Ben was enrolled in the town's grammar school, which would become the Boston Latin School. He quickly went to the head of his class and was promoted midterm to the next class. But his academic career was cut short when Josiah, reflecting on the expenses of feeding, clothing, housing, and educating his large brood, and reckoning the meager income a minister might command, decided that God would have to be satisfied with the sons of the well-to-do. Josiah briefly enrolled Ben in a school run by one George Brownell, specializing in arithmetic and writing. Ben's way with words continued to distinguish him, but numbers proved mystifyingly perverse, and the experiment was canceled. At 10, Ben entered the chandler trade, cutting wicks for candles, filling molds, waiting on customers, and running errands about the town. It was an entrancing town for a boy to run about. Boston may have begun life as a religious refuge for nonconformists, but by the beginning of the 18th century, it was looking like any number of secular seaports that dotted both shores of the North Atlantic. It was by far the busiest port in English America. More than 1,000 ships were registered with Boston's harbor master. These, in addition to the many more that were registered elsewhere, but made Boston a regular stop on the trade routes between the New World and the Old. This merchant armada brought cargoes of silk and spices from the Orient, slaves from West Africa, rum and molasses from the West Indies, manufactured goods from Britain, and foodstuffs and other raw and partially processed materials from elsewhere in North America. Only when the coldest weather encased the harbor in ice did the traffic cease. Scores of wharves lined the waterfront at the western edge of the town. The most magnificent of these was the fittingly labeled Long Wharf, which extended from the foot of King Street nearly a quarter mile into the harbor. This remarkable structure contained both a wooden roadway 30 feet wide and a string of warehouses perched on pilings above the waves. Boston did not merely service ships, it also built them. A dozen shipyards employed hundreds of skilled artisans and unskilled laborers, brawny men with arms as thick as hawsers from sawing oak logs into keels and ribbing for the hulls that would have to withstand the tempests of all the world's oceans. Dexterous men who wove those hawsers and sewed the sails that turned those tempests to propulsion and profit. Clever men who adapted standard ship designs to suit the diverse needs of this India trader, that coaster, those lobster men. Every week or so, a new hull would groan down the ways, and amid a stupendous splash and that irrepressible frisson of uncertainty as to whether she would go down to the sea or down to the sea floor, add another bottom to Boston's navy. The ocean's call tantalized every Boston boy of Ben Franklin's generation. The salt smell permeated the entire town, not least the house on Union Street, which was but a block back from the water. From his doorstep, he could see the masts of the Indiamen as they lay beside the Long Wharf. In the mornings before rising, he could hear the metal moanings of the anchor chains as the ships in the harbor made ready to run out on the ebb tide. He knew they would visit the most exotic places on earth before returning to Boston 2 or 3 or 10 years hence. He could imagine the strange and wonderful people who inhabited those exotic locales. The call of the sea had been too much for Ben's eldest brother, Josiah. 2 years before Ben was born, the younger Josiah had turned his back on the terrestrial world of his father, the world of the chandlery, of the house on Milk Street, of the South Church, of the probing gaze of the Puritan elders, and shipped out on a merchantman bound for the Indies. He never returned. For years, his father assumed he would eventually find his way back to Boston, if only for a stopover. But in 1715, when Ben was 9 years old, the grim word arrived that Josiah's vessel had been lost at sea. Thus, it was with worry and fear that the elder Josiah observed his youngest son being drawn to the waterfront. Ben later recorded that he had a strong inclination for the sea, which he indulged to the extent a young boy could against his father's disapproval. "Living near the water, I was much in and about it, learned early to swim well and to manage boats, and when in a boat or canoe with other boys, I was commonly allowed to govern, especially in any case of difficulty." The lure of the water, joined to Ben's emerging mechanical curiosity and inventiveness, prompted an early experiment. One windy day, he was flying a kite on the bank of the mill pond, an artificial enclosure that had been constructed to trap the high tide and release it through the race of a gristmill. Notwithstanding the wind, the afternoon was warm and the water inviting. Ben tied the kite to a stake in the ground, doffed his clothes, and dove in. The water was pleasantly cool, and he was reluctant to leave it, but he wanted to fly his kite some more. He pondered his dilemma until it occurred to him, that he need not forego one diversion for the other. He clambered out of the pond, untied the kite from the stake, and returned to the water. As the buoyancy of the water diminished gravity's hold on his feet, he felt the kite tugging him forward. He surrendered to the wind's power, lying on his back and letting the kite pull him clear across the pond, without the least fatigue and with the greatest pleasure imaginable. Writing from France decades later, he added, "I think it not impossible to cross in this manner from Dover to Calais." On other occasions, the youngster experimented with hand paddles to augment the power of his swimming stroke, and wooden flippers for his feet. Neither innovation was as successful as the sail kite. The paddles overly fatigued his wrists, while the flippers, being stiff, failed to mimic a fish's tail sufficiently. The mill pond was the location of at least one adventure that turned out ill. Next to the pond was a salt marsh, where Ben and the boys liked to hunt small fish. But their stalking stirred up the mud and clouded the water, frustrating their efforts to capture lunch. To mitigate the murkiness, Ben proposed that they build a jetty extending into the marsh. The only convenient building material consisted of stones recently delivered to a building site nearby. Ben suggested that the gang wait until the masons at the site went home for the evening, at which point the stones might be put to the purpose of improving the fishery. The boys waited, the men departed, and the construction commenced. After several hours and much struggling, the jetty was completed, to the boys' satisfaction and pride. The foreman of the building crew, arriving next morning, was less admiring. A cursory investigation revealed the whereabouts of the missing stones, from which the foreman deduced the identity of those responsible for their removal. The boys were remanded to their parents' custody and chastisement. Although Ben pleaded the civic usefulness of the construction, Josiah pointed out that the first civic virtue was honesty. Ben might have added that this transgression was decidedly venial compared to what other lads of the town regularly engaged in. Boston's boys had long evinced an ebullient streak, especially on Guy Fawkes Day, that November anniversary of the aborted gunpowder plot against Parliament in 1605. Clusters of youths from the south end of town would swarm past the Franklin House, which lay not far from Mill Creek, the line of demarcation between the southern and northern neighborhoods, into the north end, looking for trouble. More often than not, they found it. When they failed, they could count on discovering it back in their own neighborhood when the northerners repaid the visit. Over time, the fun grew more frequent. At the end of the 18th century, Edward Reynolds, who happened to be the great-great-grandson of Josiah Franklin's landlord on Milk Street, explained that the old feud between the Southenders and Northenders, which he described as being as old as the town itself, was the occasion of a regular battle every Thursday and Saturday afternoon. Reynolds added that the clashes were not infrequently the occasion of very serious injury to wind and limb. They were also practice in the arts applied against the agents, and then the soldiers, of King George III. Josiah Franklin was 58 when he brought Ben into the shop, and by this time of his life he was content with the predictability and security his business afforded him and his family. But the candle shop held little appeal for the boy, who found the endless pouring, trimming, cutting, and packing hopelessly dull next to the far more exciting activities happening all over town. His dissatisfaction only increased, indeed approached something akin to despair, when his elder brother John left the family firm to set himself up independently in Rhode Island, and Josiah gave every indication of commanding Ben to take his place as apprentice and future partner. The scope for rebellion by a 12-year-old boy was limited. But there was always the threat of running off to sea. A real threat even for one as young as Ben, considering the demand of the shipping trade for cabin boys. Josiah had lost his namesake this way, and he could hardly bear the thought of losing his youngest son similarly. Consequently, in a strange way, Ben gained an advantage over his father in this early contest of wills. Josiah abandoned the notion of making a chandler out of the boy and began taking him around the town to observe the other craftsmen at work in the hope that some honest calling, less dangerous than the sea, would satisfy his taste for novelty and excitement. Although no single craft commended itself above all others, cutlery appeared promising. Ben had shown some cleverness with his hands and with tools. Making and repairing knives might put that cleverness to use. Moreover, his cousin Samuel, Uncle Benjamin's boy, who had been a cutler in London, had recently relocated to Boston. Ben could apprentice with him. And so Ben was sent to live and work with Samuel on a trial basis. But Samuel demanded a maintenance fee Josiah judged excessive, not least in light of the fact that Josiah had been maintaining Samuel's father for years with no remuneration. The cutlery apprenticeship collapsed. Josiah then consulted a son of his own. James Franklin, 9 years Ben's elder, had recently returned from London where he had learned the printer's trade. He had established a shop on Queen Street, just 3 blocks from Josiah's house. There he was attempting to find a niche among the town's 4 other printers. The business began slowly, but in an era when printing provided the only feasible means of reproducing the written word on any but the most limited scale, and in a community devoted to the study of the scriptures, an activity that required and indeed produced nearly universal literacy among adult males and substantial literacy among females, James had reason to anticipate success. He believed that from a small start, printing sermons and broadsides, those all-purpose posters conveying information on everything from politics to the price of peas, he might graduate to books and other more profitable assignments. He needed a helper. Ben could serve as well as any other. In fact, Ben served very well. Printing turned out to be ideally suited to his peculiar combination of manual and intellectual dexterity. The physical process of printing was straightforward, if somewhat involved. The printer set the handwritten text in type, placing the cast metal letters, imported during this period from England, in rows that would yield the lines of printed text. These lines were held in place by rectangular frames corresponding to the printed pages. Typically, 4 pages were set and framed at once. The letters were inked, paper was laid over them and pressed against them, and the sheet of 4 pages was hung or laid aside to dry. As many sheets were pressed as copies the customer ordered. After the last impressions were made and had dried, the sheets were cut into their separate pages, which were collated and bound. The mental aspect of the craft was no less significant than the physical. Printers doubled as editors, proofreading their patrons' prose and their own typesetting, and suggesting improvements in style. In some instances, they served as co-authors or ghostwriters, filling gaps in imagination or knowledge. In addition, the printing trade shared certain activities with all businesses: accounting, marketing, inventory control, customer relations. From the beginning, Ben showed himself adept at both the physical and mental aspects of printing. His fingers flitted from type rack to frame, plucking the letters he needed and slipping them into their places. He had inherited a good set of shoulders from Josiah. As he matured and as he continued to swim at every opportunity, These grew strong enough to sling around the heavy sets of lead type and to operate the manual presses for hours at a time. His facility with language eased the chores of editing and proofing. His early acquired and always widening reading habits attuned his ear to felicitous phrasing and his eye to orthodox orthography. His failure at arithmetic proved to have been Mr. Brownell's doing more than his own. A subsequent self-study course yielded rapid progress to a mastery more than adequate for any tradesman. It didn't take James long to appreciate what Ben could bring to the printing business. He soon struck an agreement with Josiah that Ben would serve as his apprentice. The term, 9 years, was longer than that of most apprenticeships, but printing required greater skill and longer training than most trades. In other respects, the apprenticeship fit the custom of the day, which was summarized in a typical indenture document. The said apprentice, his master faithfully shall or will serve, his secrets keep, his lawful commands everywhere gladly do. The goods of his said master he shall not waste, nor the same without license of him to any give or lend. Hurt to his said master he shall not do, cause, nor procure to be done. Taverns, inns, or alehouses he shall not haunt. At cards, dice, tables, or any other unlawful game he shall not play. Matrimony he shall not contract, nor from the service of his said master day or night absent himself. But in all things, as an honest and faithful apprentice, shall and will demean and behave himself towards his said master and all his during said term. Beyond this boilerplate, James agreed to pay Ben the wages of a journeyman printer during the final year of his indenture. Although Ben deemed printing preferable to cutlery, and certainly to chandlery, and while he could see that printing was something he might be good at, he had reservations about the apprenticeship. 9 years looked an eternity to a 12-year-old, and, as he recalled later, he still had a hankering for the sea. But this hankering simply intensified Josiah's determination to seal the arrangement, and through a combination of cajolery and threat, legally a father did not require his son's approval for an apprenticeship, he induced Ben to sign the indenture papers. Before long, Ben began to appreciate the advantages of his new line of work. His appetite for reading had always grown with the eating. Of late, he had devoured Pilgrim's Progress and other works by Bunyan, Burton's Historical Collections, Plutarch's Lives, Defoe's Essay on Projects, and various of Cotton Mather's preachments. Now that he was thrown into regular contact with the most literate element in a highly literate society, he discovered that an even wider array of literature fell open to him. As apprentice to a printer, he daily dealt with apprentices to the town's booksellers. He formed an alliance with one in particular, who allowed him to borrow books from his master's collection to read after hours. Often I sat up in my room reading the greatest part of the night, when the book was borrowed in the evening and to be returned early in the morning lest it should be missed or wanted. One of James's customers, Matthew Adams, remarked this inquisitive lad and gave him direct access to the Adams family library, an impressive if quirky collection. James didn't object to his younger brother's campaign of self-improvement, as long as it didn't diminish his productivity in the press room, which it did not. In a little time, I made great proficiency in the business and became a useful hand to my brother, Ben wrote quite believably. Indeed, James soon found a way to capitalize on the boy's literary bent. A common entertainment in those days consisted of poems struck off on the occasion of important or otherwise noteworthy events. Ben had been reading verses from the Adams Library, and he determined to have a try at the genre. An early effort memorialized the sad drowning of the keeper of a local lighthouse, his wife and daughter, and a friend and a slave. Beyond the basic human appeal of a story of the untimely death of loved ones, especially including a sweet and innocent young girl, the tragedy had special resonance in a society that lived by the sea, and consequently too often died by the sea. Whether or not Ben comprehended all the facets of his tale, he knocked out a piece called The Lighthouse Tragedy, which he and James quickly printed up. A much older, more sophisticated Franklin called it wretched stuff in the Grub Street ballad style. But he had to admit that it sold wonderfully. He added frankly, "This flattered my vanity." The plaudits and the profits inspired another venture into verse, a ballad commemorating the recent killing of the notorious pirate Edward Teach, commonly called Blackbeard. "Will you hear of a bloody battle lately fought upon the seas? It will make your ears to rattle and your admiration seize. Have you heard of Teach the Rover and his knavery on the main? How of gold he was a lover, how he loved all ill-got gain?" There were several more stanzas climaxing on the quarterdeck. "Teach and Maynard on the quarter fought it out most manfully. Maynard's sword did cut him shorter. Losing his head, he there did die." Perhaps because this poem lacked the romantic tragic element, it sold less well than Ben's first. Closer comparison is impossible, as the first doesn't survive. Josiah had frowned on his son's poetic efforts, ridiculing them and warning that verse makers were generally beggars. But as long as the lighthouse tale belied the warning, Ben ignored the criticism. Yet now the ridicule stung more sharply and the warning rang louder, and the boy abandoned balladic Grub Street for more respectable precincts of prose. By a matter of luck and untutored good taste, his guides to those precincts turned out to be some of the finest prose stylists of the day. Previously, Ben had honed his argumentative skills on a friend of similarly bookish bent. On one occasion, Ben and this John Collins disputed the prudence and appropriateness of educating girls beyond basic literacy. Ben, who took the affirmative, believed he had the better of the argument on merits, but conceded that Collins was the more persuasive presenter. Ben hoped to gain an advantage by shifting ground from the spoken word to the written. But here again he discovered that his arguments lacked the eloquence and power of his opponents. Josiah, who happened across some of Ben's papers, concurred, pointing out particular deficiencies in style and approach. Frustrated and now somewhat embarrassed, Ben determined to remedy the situation. He had recently encountered an early issue of The Spectator, the London journal soon to be famous for the essays of Joseph Addison and Richard Steele. Ben read this number front to back, then back to front and all over again. Entranced by the author's ease of exposition, he adopted The Spectator's style as a model for his own. He devised elaborate exercises to absorb the principles that underlay its phrases. He would read passages, then try to recapitulate them from memory. On the reasoning that poetry demands a larger vocabulary than prose, a given meaning must also fit the pattern of rhyme and meter, he reworked the Spectator essays into verse, and subsequently back into prose again. He took notes on the essays, then deliberately scrambled the notes before attempting to reconstruct the original order, the better to appreciate the art of rhetorical organization. He shunned sleep, sitting up late with his quill pen and a sheaf of papers salvaged from the printing shop scrap pile, then rising early to fit in a few more exercises before James entered the shop and the real work of the day commenced. He exploited James's relative unconcern at the state of his younger brother's soul to steal Sundays from the South Church and its sacred texts for the print shop and his secular volumes. Josiah, missing his youngest son at services, disapproved but declined to intervene between master and apprentice. Perhaps he already recognized that Ben's zeal for the word of man would forever outstrip his zeal for the word of God. The former sentiment was a powerful motivator. Referring to his efforts to make himself a writer, Ben admitted afterward, "I was extremely ambitious." He had a chance to gratify that ambition and to measure his literary advancement after James began publishing The New England Current in 1721. During the previous 2 years, James had been the printer, but not the publisher, of the Boston Gazette, which, like other papers of that era, was something of an adjunct to and perquisite of the office of the Boston postmaster. Postmasters had first knowledge of most of the news that came in, by post frequently, from the outside world. This news could be recycled in one's own paper. Moreover, a postmaster could exploit his command of the outgoing mails to arrange distribution of his paper in preference to, or to the exclusion of, competitors' publications. But because the postmastership was a public office, postmasters' papers, including the Gazette, tended to tread lightly on issues relating to government. The Gazette boasted that it was published by authority. It read as though it were published by the authorities. James Franklin thought Boston deserved better, and after his printing contract with the Gazette ran out, he determined to start his own paper. This one would be lively, opinionated, and not averse to challenging the establishment. No one so represented the establishment as Cotton Mather. James's new paper, the New England Current, announced its birth with a scathing attack on Mather. The occasion of the attack was an epidemic of smallpox, the first in nearly 2 decades, which hiatus was a primary cause of the virulence of this outbreak, in that an unexposed generation had little or no resistance to the disease. For all his obsession with the supernatural, Mather had maintained his youthful interest in the natural, and he advocated the novel technique of inoculation to combat the contagion. James Franklin knew next to nothing of the etiology of smallpox, but he knew he despised Mather for what James judged the eminent minister's smugness and his inordinate influence over the life of Boston. If Mather advocated inoculation, the Current must oppose it, and did. The campaign of opposition accomplished no good for the health of the community. Nearly 10% of the population died before the disease ran its course. In fairness to James, the preponderance of medical knowledge at the time was on his side regarding the inefficacy of inoculation. One of his collaborators in opposition was William Douglas, a physician educated at the best English and continental European universities. But whatever its effects on public health, the anti-inoculation campaign served James's purpose of shaking the status quo. The status quo shook back. Increase Mather publicly denounced the vile Current and said he could well remember when the civil government would have taken an effectual course to suppress such a cursed libel. Samuel Mather, Cotton's son and an apparent beneficiary of inoculation, wrote semi-anonymously, and that not for long, in the Gazette that the Current was trying to vilify and abuse the best men we have. He warned that there is a number of us who resolve that if this wickedness be not stopped, we will pluck up our courage and see what we can do in our way to stop it. Many readers heard the voice of Cotton Mather in an unsigned complaint to the Boston Newsletter decrying the notorious scandalous paper called The Current, and charging said screed sheet with purveying nonsense, unmanliness, raillery, profaneness, immorality, arrogance, calumnies, lies, contradictions, and what not, all tending to quarrels and divisions, and to debauch and corrupt the minds and manners of New England. Whether or not those precise words were Cotton Mather's, the sentiments surely were. In his diary, Mather wrote of the wicked printer and his accomplices, who every week publish a vile paper to lessen and blacken the ministers of the town and render their ministry ineffectual. With the battle joined, James Franklin sought allies. At this early stage, the list of current contributors comprised only James and a few kindred skeptics. To create the illusion of numbers, the publisher-editor and his friends employed the common journalistic tactic of writing under noms de plume: Abigail Afterwit, Timothy Turnstone, Harry Meanwell, Fanny Mournful, and others. These fictitious personages graced the paper with sharp-penned commentary on issues of the day. Not surprisingly, they tended to endorse the paper's editorial views. Consequently, it was with pleasure that James awoke one morning to discover beneath the door of the print shop a contribution from a genuine outsider. Actually, this contributor was not an outsider at all. It was Ben Franklin, who had observed the genesis of The Current and its challenge to Mather in the Massachusetts hierarchy, but who conspicuously had not been invited to join the undertaking. Because he had not, and because he realized that James might be less than enthusiastic about his younger brother's participation in the new project, Ben carefully disguised his handwriting and signed the letter, "Silence Do Good." James read the missive with growing delight, which increased the more from his appreciation that the author's very name tweaked Cotton Mather, whose recently published Silentarius followed his earlier Bonifacius, or Essays to Do Good. James shared the Do Good letter with his colleagues. They registered equal approval. James ran it in the April 2, 1723 issue of The Current. Mrs. Dugood introduced herself to current patrons by chaffing them for contemporary unwillingness either to commend or dispraise what they read until they are in some measure informed who or what the author of it is, whether he be poor or rich, old or young, a scholar or a leather apron man. She, or Ben Franklin rather, proceeded to mock this timidity by fabricating a fanciful background for herself. She had, she said, been born at sea, en route from the Old England to New England. But the joy surrounding her birth had turned to sorrow almost at once, when a huge wave swept across the deck of the vessel and carried her celebrating father to his watery doom. It was a misfortune, Silence said, which, though I was not then capable of knowing, I shall never be able to forget. The death of her father had made an indigent of her mother, with the result that the infant Silence was placed in foster care outside Boston, where she passed her childhood in vanity and idleness until being bound over to a country minister, a pious, good-natured young man and a bachelor. This godly fellow instructed the girl in all that was necessary for the female sex to learn: needlework, writing, arithmetic, etc. Had James known of Ben's earlier defense of education for girls, he might have guessed the identity of Silence Dugood at this point. Because she displayed a head for books, the minister allowed her the run of his library, which, though it was but small, yet it was well chosen to inform the understanding rightly and enable the mind to frame great and noble ideas. This bucolic idyll was interrupted briefly by the news that her poor mother had died. "Leaving me, as it were, by myself, having no relation on earth within my knowledge," but soon enough it resumed. I passed away the time with a mixture of profit and pleasure, having no affliction but what was imaginary and created in my own fancy, as nothing is more common with us women than to be grieving for nothing when we have nothing else to grieve for. Almost certainly, none of the readers of The Current guessed that this ironically knowing voice belonged to a 16-year-old boy. Neither did James, who inserted after Silence Dugood's first epistle an invitation for more. Any such additional missives could be delivered to the printing house or to the candle shop of Josiah Franklin. No questions shall be asked of the bearer. Ben later said he felt exquisite pleasure at the approbation this first effort in journalism elicited. He took particular satisfaction from listening to James and the others guess who the anonymous author might be. None were named but men of some character among us for learning and ingenuity. During the next 6 months, Ben continued his correspondence, delivering 15 do-good letters in all. His topics ranged from love to learning to lamenting the death of dear ones. As in the first letter, insight and irony were evenly matched. Silence related how, to her astonishment, her ministerial benefactor presently essayed to woo her. There is certainly scarce any part of a man's life in which he appears more silly and ridiculous than when he makes his first onset in courtship. As Ben was of an age, if not an economic condition, to consider courtship, the reader who knows the identity of Silence Dugood discerns a certain dawning in him of the difficulties of the endeavor. But gratitude inclined Silence to accept his suit, leading to wedlock and the height of conjugal love and mutual endearments, not to mention two likely girls and a boy. Tragically, her husband was carried off by illness almost as suddenly as her father had been swept away by the ocean, and Silence was left to look after herself and her offspring. Yet, as she assured readers, especially the men among them, "I could be easily persuaded to marry again. I am courteous and affable, good-humored, unless I am first provoked, and handsome, and sometimes witty." Silence satirized the state of higher education in Boston. Lampooning Harvard College, the alma mater of Cotton Mather, among other establishment influentials, as a snobbish ivory tower where students learn little more than how to carry themselves handsomely and enter a room genteelly, which might as well be acquired at a dancing school, and from whence they return, after abundance of trouble and charge, as great blockheads as ever, only more proud and conceited. She chided men for being as foolish as the women they criticized for idleness and folly. Are not the men to blame for their folly in maintaining us in idleness? She scoffed at women for silliness equal to men's. How else to explain hoop petticoats, those monstrous topsy-turvy mortar pieces that looked more like engines of war than ornaments of the fair sex? Having experienced multiple deaths in her family, she offered a formula for eulogizing departed loved ones, pointing out that tears were the easier to elicit the more unexpected and violent the demise. It will be best if he went away suddenly, being killed, drowned, or froze to death. The address in such a case ought to include a litany of melancholy expressions, such as dreadful, deadly, cruel, cold death, unhappy fate, weeping eyes. An experienced speaker would wring the maximal lacrimation from an audience, but in a pinch, anyone could deliver the doleful sentiments. Put them into the empty skull of some young Harvard, but in case you have ne'er a one at hand, you may use your own. Rhymes were nice. Power, flower. Quiver, shiver. Grieve us, leave us. A concluding flourish was the mark of a really distinguished graveside encomium. If you can procure a scrap of Latin to put at the end, it will garnish it mightily. Had they come from the pen of a mature writer, the Do-Good Letters would deserve to be considered a delightful example of social satire. Coming as they did from the pen of a mere youth, they reveal emerging genius. Some of what Franklin wrote he might have experienced indirectly. Some he extrapolated from his reading. Much he must simply have imagined. But the tone is uniformly confident and true to the character he created. Silence is irreverent and full of herself, yet she brings most readers, the proud and powerful excepted, into the realm of her sympathy. They laugh when she laughs, and laugh at whom she laughs at. She's one of the more memorable minor characters of American literature, and all the more memorable for being the creation of a 16-year-old boy. Silence Do-Good's early offerings afforded distraction from the controversies that continue to roil the town. A visitor to Boston had limned the environs and their inhabitants. The houses in some parts join, as in London, the buildings, like their women, being neat and handsome, and their streets, like the hearts of the male inhabitants, are paved with pebble. Many of those pebbled hearts agreed with James Franklin that the public pietism of the Mathers and their ecclesiastical allies had grown intolerable. One anti-clerical militant, perhaps still sore from the witch trials, went so far as to throw a bomb into Cotton Mather's house. The explosive device failed to detonate, leaving the target to intone, "This night there stood by me the angel of the God whose I am and whom I serve." The failure also allowed Mather to read the appended message. "Cotton Mather, you dog, damn you. I'll inoculate you with this, with a pox to you." James Franklin preferred bombs of the printed sort. Oddly, it was one of his lesser fireworks that triggered the strongest reaction. In June 1722, James printed a faked letter to the editor, in which the writer, that is, James himself, suggested that the authorities were remiss in failing to pursue with adequate vigor pirates who were afflicting the New England coast that season. Of the captain named to head the posse, the Current said sarcastically, "'Tis thought he will sail sometime this month if wind and weather permit." For this disrespect, the Massachusetts General Court ordered that James be jailed. Many observers judged the reaction disproportionate to the provocation. A commonly accepted explanation was that ever since the smallpox scuffles, the court had been seeking an excuse to silence the turbulent pressmen. This was simply the excuse that fell to hand. In connection with his brother's arrest, Ben was briefly detained and questioned. But on the reasoning that as an apprentice he was legally required to follow his master's orders, the magistrates released him. As a result of James's imprisonment, Ben found himself the acting publisher and managing editor of the Current. Josiah Franklin earlier had implicitly acknowledged Ben's strong-headedness in releasing him from the candle shop. James had encountered some of that same independence of mind in the 4 years following. Ben's recent surreptitious success with Silence Do-Good hadn't reduced his opinion of himself. Now he was in charge of the whole printing and publishing operation. It was enough to swell the vanity of any 16-year-old. "I made bold to give our rulers some rubs," he boasted afterward. On behalf of free thinkers everywhere, not to mention James languishing in jail, Silence Do-Good contradicted her Christian name. "Without freedom of thought, there can be no such thing as wisdom," she quoted from an English paper, "and no such thing as public liberty without freedom of speech, which is the right of every man. Whoever would overthrow the liberty of a nation must begin by subduing the freeness of speech, a thing terrible to public traitors. This talk of traitors was strong stuff, but silence had not finished. It has been for some time a question with me whether a commonwealth suffers more by hypocritical pretenders to religion or by the openly profane. Some late thoughts of this nature have inclined me to think that the hypocrite is the most dangerous person of the two, especially if he sustains a post in the government. The openly profane person deceived no one, and thereby limited the damage he could cause. But the godly hypocrite enlisted the unwitting many into his malign service. They take him for a saint and pass him for one, without considering that they are, as it were, the instruments of public mischief out of conscience, and ruin their country for God's sake. James won his release from jail after a month, following a public apology and a physician's report that confinement was harming his health. Yet he reconsidered his repentance about the same time he recovered his health. And by the beginning of 1723, the current, again under his direction, was taxing the council in language like that which Ben had placed in the mouth of Mrs. Duguid. "Whenever I find a man full of religious cant and palaver," the January 14th issue opined, "I presently suspect him of being a knave. Religion is indeed the principal thing, but too much of it is worse than none at all. The world abounds with knaves and villains, but of all knaves, the religious knave is the worst, and villainies acted under the cloak of religion are the most execrable." Once more, the hammer of authority fell. Declaring that the tendency of the current was to mock religion and bring it into disrespect, the general court ordered that James Franklin, the printer and publisher thereof, be strictly forbidden by this court to print or publish the New England Current unless he submitted each issue of the paper to the censor for prior approval. Briefly, James defied the order, publishing additional provocations. But when the sheriff came round with a warrant for another arrest, he fled his shop and went into hiding. From underground, not far underground, as it happened, the sheriff didn't look very hard, he arranged to continue the Current's crusade. The court's order applied to James Franklin. It said nothing about Benjamin Franklin. James told Ben to keep publishing, but under his own name. In order to prevent the court from acting against Ben as James's apprentice, James released Ben from his indenture, signing the back of the original agreement and discharging his brother from all obligations. Ben was to keep the endorsed document handy to show the sheriff and anyone else who doubted that Ben was really his own man. But, in fact, Ben was not his own man. As a secret condition of his release from the original indenture, James made his brother sign a new sub rosa agreement covering the scheduled last years of the apprenticeship. In public, Ben was free. In private, he remained bound. Yet he was in charge, which counted for something. The February 11th, 1723 issue of the Current explained that James Franklin had entirely dropped the undertaking. This was not quite true, but it grew truer by the week. With each issue, the paper lost a little of James's character and took on more of Ben's. Where James swung his pen like a broadsword, Ben wielded a rapier. His satire was always light, never ponderous. It usually brought smiles to objective lips and must occasionally have turned up the corners of even Cotton Mather's mouth. With his own name now on the masthead, Ben refrained from labeling the colony's notables hypocrites. Instead, he spoofed their obsession with titles. Adam was never called Master Adam. We never read of Noah Esquire, Lot Knight and Baronet, nor the Right Honorable Abraham, Viscount Mesopotamia, Baron of Charan. We never read of the Reverend Moses, nor the Right Reverend Father in God Aaron by Divine Providence, Lord Archbishop of Israel. He got his point across, less dramatically, but more effectively than James had. To some extent, Ben's oblique style reflected a rhetorical technique he had picked up from his reading. Xenophon and other authors had introduced him to the Socratic method of argument by inquiry. Ben quickly divined that this would be more effective than the confrontational approach he had been accustomed to use against the likes of John Collins. "I was charmed with it," he said of the indirect method, "adopted it, dropped my abrupt contradiction and positive argumentation, and put on the humble inquirer and doubter." Applied to assorted questions, philosophical, theological, and political, the new approach exceeded his fondest expectations. "I took a delight in it, practiced it continually, and grew very artful and expert in drawing people, even of superior knowledge, into concessions, the consequences of which they did not foresee, entangling them in difficulties out of which they could not extricate themselves, and so obtaining victories that neither myself nor my cause always deserved." But to some extent, Ben's decision to de-escalate the current's confrontation with counsel and court reflected tactical matters touching his personal standing vis-a-vis James. At 12, Ben had been willing, if grudgingly, to accept the terms of his apprenticeship to James. A boy with neither skills nor capital could hardly make his way in the world alone. But at 17, his circumstances were decidedly different. Although technically not even a journeyman printer, he was as proficient in the craft as many masters. He was at least as clever a writer as James himself had implicitly admitted by the praise he lavished on Silence Do-Good, before discovering, as he eventually did, who the widow was, when his praise suddenly ceased. Yet James's colleagues continued to applaud Ben after he dropped the veil of silence, which irritated James the more. "He thought, probably with reason, that it tended to make me too vain." When the two brothers took their differences to their father, the old man sided with his younger son. "Because I was either generally in the right or else a better pleader." This made James all the angrier. In his anger, he frequently beat Ben, who took this physical form of insult extremely amiss. He added parenthetically from amid the American challenge to British colonial rule during the early 1770s, "I fancy his harsh and tyrannical treatment of me might be a means of impressing me with that aversion to arbitrary power that has stuck to me through my whole life." Ben had little doubt he could manage on his own by now. Better than most apprentices, he knew how much it cost to support himself. James was unmarried and for this reason did not keep house himself, but boarded with another family. He paid that family for meals. When he took Ben on as apprentice, he paid them for Ben's board, too. After Ben happened upon a book extolling the virtues of vegetarianism, the boy decided to try it. This occasioned some inconvenience with his hosts and provoked additional upbraiding from James. So Ben, after calculating the cost of beef and pork as compared to potatoes and rice, offered to board himself for half the amount James was paying their hosts. James agreed, freeing Ben to discover that even this half was twice what it really cost to feed himself. The balance he spent on books. "I had another advantage in it," Ben remarked of his new regimen. "My brother and the rest, going from the printing house to their meals, I remained there alone, and dispatching presently my light repast, which often was no more than a biscuit or a slice of bread, a handful of raisins or a tart from the pastry cooks and a glass of water, had the rest of the time till their return for study, in which I made the greater progress from that greater clearness of head and quicker apprehension, which usually attend temperance in eating and drinking. By the evidence of his recurrent arguments with James, I was frequently chid for my singularity. Ben made little effort to disguise the feeling of moral superiority his discovery of vegetarianism afforded him. Together with the intellectual superiority he felt after the triumph of Silence Do Good, he must have seemed insufferable to his older brother. He himself admitted as much after the fact. Perhaps I was too saucy and provoking. Wherever the demerits lay, Ben decided that his situation with James had grown intolerable. And this conclusion, along with the other reasons, cautioned him against unnecessary affront to the ministerial-magisterial axis of Boston. Several months after his 17th birthday, he determined to break his indenture to James. This would be illegal. His second contract with James bound him for 3 years more. But because this contract was secret, Ben reasoned, James would have difficulty enforcing it. Ben could deny its existence. For James to affirm it in any court of law would reveal the sham by which he had evaded the general court's cease and desist order and open him to contempt charges. By now, James had come out of hiding, but had posted a sizable bond for good behavior. Ben reckoned that the bond money was his own guarantee of James's silence on the indenture issue. It seemed a sound plan, but Ben couldn't place too much trust in it. James had friends who disliked the censorious ways of the Mather clique as much as he did. Already one grand jury had refused to indict him on contempt charges. It was conceivable that opinion's wheel would turn and James would be hailed as a free speech hero. Such circumstances might embolden him to press his indenture claim against Ben. From Ben's perspective, the safest course appeared to be to make no more enemies than necessary. James guessed what his brother was thinking. And even before Ben began inquiring around town for other printing work, James preempted him by pledging his fellow printers to eschew his brother's services. He also enlisted Josiah, who, while sympathetic to his youngest boy on minor points within the framework of the indenture pact, sided with James on the moral and civic necessity of preserving the framework as a whole. Consequently, Ben saw no recourse but flight, which recommended itself on other grounds as well. To a curious boy, Boston had been an exciting place. To an independent-minded young man, it was starting to stifle. The Mathers didn't say such threatening things about Ben as about James, but it was clear they and their supporters had doubts about the younger Franklin, too. Reports of his inquiring and skeptical mind were circulating. My indiscreet disputations about religion began to make me pointed at with horror by good people as an infidel or atheist. Ben added that he had become obnoxious to the governing party. Now might be a good time to leave, before the clerics and judges came after him as they had come after James. It was likely I might, if I stayed, soon bring myself into scrapes. So he plotted his flight, selling some of his books to raise money for ship passage to New York. He sent his friend John Collins to tell the captain that he needed to board the boat secretly because he had got a girl pregnant and was being pressed to marry her. The captain, evidently a man of the world, understood. He pocketed Ben's money and found something to examine at the opposite rail of the ship while Ben slipped aboard. On an outgoing tide and a fair September wind, Ben Franklin fled the town of his birth and youth, carrying only the few shillings in his pocket and all the self-assurance of his nearly 18 years. Chapter 2. Friends and Other Strangers, 1723 and 1724. Only later, with age and distance, would Franklin learn to appreciate the more admirable aspects of Cotton Mather's character and thinking. Now, upon leaving Boston, he landed in a city established by a contemporary of Mather's, but a man whose view of the proper relation between ministers and magistrates could hardly have been more different from Mather's, or more congenial to Franklin, both then and during the rest of Franklin's life. William Penn first ran afoul of religious authority at about the same age as Franklin, and at about the same time as Josiah Franklin, then still in England. Attending university in Oxford, Penn fell under the sway of the Quaker Thomas Lowe, and when Charles II restored strict enforcement of Anglican orthodoxy, Penn resisted. Whether he was thrown out of Oxford or departed of his own disgust at what now seemed to him a den of hellish ignorance and debauchery was perhaps a fine point. In either case, he left. His father, the formidable Admiral Sir William Penn, was not any more pleased than the boy's tutors at his strange beliefs. He greeted the lad with blows, turned him out of the house, and threatened to disown him. Paternal displeasure aside, Sir William may simply have been a difficult man to get along with. His neighbor and Navy colleague Samuel Pepys had to put up with him for professional reasons, but declared in his diary, "I hate him with all my heart." On the other hand, it may have been Pepys who was the difficult one. Although he did not disdain his neighbor's invitations to dinner, he complained confidentially that Mrs. Penn's cooking stank like the very devil. The threat of disownment triggered a temporary lapse from Quaker conscience. Young William reconciled with his father and went off to the continent for a holiday at the court of Louis XIV. He did not stay long, and by 1667 was securely back within the fold of his English friends. He published a series of tracts contending for freedom of conscience. He preached the same doctrine before crowds large and small. In 1670, he was arrested for unlawful address to an unruly assembly. At the trial, he argued eloquently that a man's mind and soul must remain beyond the reach of the magistrate. The jury voted to acquit, whereupon the judge ordered the jury arrested. The latter arrests were subsequently overturned in a case that became a landmark in the evolution of the common law. At about this time, Penn's father died. The admiral had learned to accept his son's sincerity, if not his beliefs, and he left young William a sizable fortune. This included an annuity of £1,500 and, more portentously for English and American history, a claim of £16,000 upon the impecunious Charles for loans outstanding. The younger Penn was in and out of prison during this period, for declining to doff his hat in court, for further unauthorized preaching, for refusing to take an oath of allegiance to the crown. When he wasn't behind bars, he spent extended periods in Europe disseminating Quaker ideas and values. In court, in prison, and on the continent, he sharpened his arguments for religious toleration. And when a Quaker friend who had an interest in what would become the colony of New Jersey ran into financial trouble and needed rescue, Penn took the opportunity to draft a set of concessions and agreements for the venture, guaranteeing to settlers the most sweeping religious liberty anywhere in England's empire. Unfortunately for freedom of conscience in New Jersey, the concessions never went into effect, being swallowed up in some further commercial restructuring of the colony. Disappointed, but determined to try again, Penn pressed Charles to redeem his debt to him by granting him a large tract of land west of New Jersey. Charles consented, and after some haggling, Penn became the proprietor of what may have been the largest single piece of real estate ever legally held by someone other than a monarch. Penn wanted to call the well-forested territory Sylvania, but Charles insisted on honoring the admiral, not the son, by prefixing Penn. Both parties were happy to portray the transaction as a case of balancing the royal books, but both understood that there was more involved. Speaking of himself and his fellow friends, Penn observed, "The government was anxious to be rid of us at so cheap a price." As proprietor of Pennsylvania, Penn enjoyed sweeping powers subject only to the constraints of the common law, applicable parliamentary measures such as the Navigation Acts, and the sensitivities of imperial politics. This left a great deal of latitude in all his longitude. He immediately prescribed the closest thing to democracy within the empire, allowing the election of a representative council based on universal manhood suffrage. Not surprisingly, in light of his convictions, both the theological kind and those handed down by the courts, he guaranteed freedom of religion. Equally predictably, in light of the pacifism of the Quakers, he called for amicable relations with the Indian tribes that occupied his new possessions. In the autumn of 1682, just several months before Josiah Franklin left England for Boston, Penn traveled to America for the first time. He wished to see the forests and streams he had heard so much about. He also wanted to walk the streets, notional though they yet were, of the large town or city he had directed be laid out on the west bank of the Delaware River. Philadelphia, the name was a neoclassical rendering of brotherly love, was the first planned city in America, and among the first in the world. Its plan reflected Penn's desire to mitigate the ills attached to old world cities. The great plague and fire of the 1660s still seared the memories of Londoners. Penn would combat these egregious civic afflictions by making Philadelphia airy and open, a green country town which will never be burnt and always be wholesome. The main streets would be 100 feet across, wider than anything in London, and the lesser avenues 50 feet, all arranged in a regular rectangular grid. Lots would be large, half an acre or an acre, with room enough for gardens and orchards to surround houses set well back from the street. Four squares of several acres each and a central square of 10 acres would guarantee additional open space to the city's inhabitants. Unlike Boston, New York, and other colonial towns, Philadelphia would have no walls or fortifications. Penn's enlightened Indian policy would provide all the protection necessary. Reality on the American frontier did not immediately match Penn's vision. Early inhabitants dug dwellings out of the steep banks of the Delaware River, living alternately amid the mud and dust of wet seasons and dry. Pigs, goats, chickens, dogs, and the occasional cow ran loose through the streets of the town, feeding on, in some cases, and contributing to, in all cases, the garbage and filth that made the summer air excruciatingly pungent. Front Street was a standing cesspool. But time softened the rough edges, and by the beginning of the 18th century, the town was starting to approach Penn's blueprint. The inhabitants numbered somewhat more than 2,000, and they gave evidence of having been busy. A recent arrival from Sweden declared, "If anyone were to see Philadelphia who had not been there, he would be astonished beyond measure that it was founded less than 20 years ago. All the houses are built of brick, 300 or 400 of them, and in every house a shop, so that whatever one wants at any time he can have for money." Money, however, was a problem. Philadelphia, like Boston, New York, and other North American cities, suffered from the chronic affliction of colonial commerce, a lack of money. The early 18th century was the heyday of mercantilism in British imperial thought and practice. According to the mercantilists, the measure of imperial power was ready cash to build navies, outfit privateers, and pay mercenaries, besides less martial purposes. The function of colonies was to foster a favorable trade balance, which would funnel cash, most liquidly or solidly rather, in the form of gold and silver, into the treasury of the monarch and into the pockets of his inhabitants in the metropolis, from whom it could be extracted when necessity arose. The maturity of the English economy relative to that of the American colonies, augmented by the navigation, that is, trade laws passed by Parliament during the 17th century, ensured that money would flow into England with ease in payment for high-value manufactured goods and flow out in payment for low-value raw materials with difficulty. The result was a perennial shortfall of cash among colonial merchants and their customers. As a result, the colonists were often reduced to barter. One Philadelphia shipbuilder, James West, recorded charging £39 for building a sloop. His customer lacked cash, so West accepted payment in flour, butter, sugar, raisins, and beer. Partly because this was a recurrent problem, he had gone into the sideline of operating a tavern. He served the proceeds from his ship contract to his patrons. As part of this redefinition of liquidity, West boarded his boat rights at the tavern and paid them their wages in beer. In good times, the dearth of money was merely annoying. In bad times, it threatened to strangle the colonial economy. And times were rarely worse than following the collapse of the South Sea bubble in 1720. The South Sea Company had been chartered in 1711 and granted a monopoly of British trade with South America and the islands of the Pacific Ocean, formerly and still sentimentally the South Sea. During the next several years, this monopoly rewarded shareholders handsomely, prompting wealthy and influential individuals, including King George I and many close to the court, to purchase stock. To tighten the company's connections to the crown still further, the directors made George a governor of the company in 1718. A year later, the directors concocted a scheme to privatize the national debt. They would assume the crown's obligations in exchange for an annual payment, and, most significantly, the chance to persuade the crown's creditors to exchange their notes for stock in the South Sea Company. With the company's stock appreciating rapidly, the task of persuasion was easy enough, which made the stock rise all the faster. Between January and July of 1720, it octupled in value, sucking in all manner of speculators and inspiring no end of imitators. In August, the inevitable occurred. The price broke. By November, nearly 9/10 of the stock value of the company had vanished, shaking such rocks of the establishment as the Bank of England, disgracing the directors of the company, who proved to have collaborated in assorted other shenanigans with the company's accounts, ruining thousands of investors, and wreaking havoc on the finances of the entire British Empire. Philadelphia was still reeling when Ben Franklin arrived in October 1723. If he had known how bad things were, he might not have come. In any event, Philadelphia was not his first choice. Franklin's original plan upon leaving Boston was to settle in New York, the thriving town on the island at the mouth of the Hudson River that retained the Dutch character of its founders, including the burghers' ambitions of worldly success. In such a setting, a young man of similar ambition ought to have no difficulty finding work, unbothered by the formalities of an unfulfilled contract back in Boston. But once out of Boston, Franklin found himself at the mercy of forces beyond his control. After 2 days at sea, the fair wind that had swept his escape vessel south failed, leaving the fugitive and his shipmates becalmed near Block Island, off the mouth of Narragansett Bay. The ship's hands, accustomed to the vagaries of sea travel, employed the time to fish for the cod that had drawn seafarers to the northeastern coast of America for more than 2 centuries. The fish were thick, and the crew hauled them up by the hundredweight. The smaller ones were cleaned, boned, and tossed into a pan of hot oil, emerging moments later golden brown, steaming hot, and exuding an aroma that enclouded the ship and stirred the digestive juices of all hands and passengers. When he had entered the ship, Ben Franklin still held to his vegetarian philosophy. One leg of this philosophy, which proscribed both flesh and fish, was economic. The other was moral. The essence of the latter was that the creatures to be eaten had done nothing to deserve death at the hands of humans, and therefore ought to be allowed to live out their innocent lives. Franklin continued to reason thus as the first codfish were pulled up over the ship's gunwales. But his reason wavered as the smell of the frying fish wafted across the deck. Before his vegetarian days, he, like most Bostonians, had loved fish, fried, steamed, boiled, stewed. The present smell conjured recollections of memorable meals past, and he decided to revisit the argument for interspecies pacifism. To his delight, he discovered a loophole. I recollected that when the fish were opened, I saw smaller fish taken out of their stomachs. Then I thought, if you eat one another, I don't see why we mayn't eat you. And so he did, dining very heartily with the rest of the passengers and crew. This was the beginning of the end of Ben Franklin's vegetarianism. He remarked later, with signature irony, "So convenient a thing it is to be a reasonable creature, since it enables one to find or make a reason for everything one has a mind to do." The ship's eventual arrival in New York overturned Franklin's expectations in another respect. For all their commercial energy, perhaps because of it, the Dutch merchants and tradesmen in Manhattan evinced scant interest in the services of printers. The town lacked a newspaper, the merchants evidently being too busy to read about the world they lived in. And sermons had no such sale as in Boston, the merchants being equally unable to focus on the world to which they were going. The single printer who kept a shop in New York, William Bradford, had no difficulty supplying the town's needs with the helpers he already had. There was no room for Franklin. But Bradford had a son, Andrew, who operated a print shop in Philadelphia. Andrew had just lost a journeyman, a promising and engaging young fellow who had died suddenly. A replacement was needed. William Bradford thought it worth Franklin's time to explore the possibility. Franklin could see little alternative. The money that remained from the sale of his books wouldn't last more than several days, and he had no marketable skill but what he had learned in James's print shop. Philadelphia had the added attraction of being even farther from Boston. It seemed unlikely that James would send someone after him, but it wouldn't hurt to put another 100 miles between himself and what he owed on his apprenticeship. The first 15 of those miles proved to be the hardest. Husbanding his shrinking supply of cash, Franklin boarded the cheapest boat he could find to carry him across the estuary of the Hudson to Perth Amboy. But an autumn squall caught the craft mid-passage and tore away its rotted sail. preventing it from entering the sheltered strait west of Staten Island, driving it instead east across the Hudson's mouth toward Long Island. Amid the pitching of the small vessel, a drunken Dutch passenger was hurled overboard. Franklin, the most alert and active person on the boat, pulled him back in by the scruff of his shaggy head. The fellow, sobered only slightly by his close brush with a watery death, proceeded to fall asleep in the scuttle. As the wind drove the stricken vessel closer to Long Island, Franklin and the others looked for a suitable landing. But the beach was rocky and the surf high, and to risk both was more than the ferryman was willing. So they dropped anchor to ride out the storm. By now, the drunken Dutchman clearly had the better part of the bargain. The spray from the water had doused everyone almost as thoroughly as his ducking had wetted him, but at least he was unconscious. Some villagers on shore saw the boat bouncing beyond the breakers. The ferryman, Franklin, and the others shouted for them to come fetch them in smaller boats they could see lying by. But the villagers chose not to hazard their lives for these strangers and went back to their houses. Although the wind gradually abated, Franklin and the others spent a most uncomfortable night on the water, cold, wet, hungry, and thirsty. A single dirty bottle of rum had to sustain them as what should have been a passage of a few hours stretched well beyond 24. The next morning, with the storm over and the wind shifting again to the east, the master of the craft jury-rigged a sheet that carried them by nightfall on the second day to Perth Amboy. Franklin, feverish from the strain and the exposure, collapsed into the first bed he could find. Just before passing out, however, he remembered reading somewhere that a large dose of water at the outset of a fever could forestall it. So he quaffed several glasses, then collapsed again. During most of the night he tossed fitfully, sweating profusely. But finally he fell asleep, and he awoke feeling as hale as healthy 17-year-olds generally do. He made another ferry passage, uneventful this time, across the Raritan River, and set out on foot in the direction of Burlington. There he hoped to catch a boat down the Delaware for Philadelphia. The storm of 2 days earlier had given way to a hard rain, which, after what he had already experienced, dampened his spirits as much as his body. I was thoroughly soaked and by noon a good deal tired, so I stopped at a poor inn where I stayed all night, beginning now to wish that I had never left home. Moreover, in his bedraggled condition, he looked the fugitive he was, or something similar. I found by the questions asked me I was suspected to be some runaway servant, and in danger of being taken up on that suspicion. But he kept to himself, found a dark corner to the side of the fire, and retired early. The next morning he headed out with the first travelers and made it almost to Burlington by nightfall. This evening passed more pleasantly than the previous. His host, a Dr. Brown, delighted to find a guest whose reading and interests approached his. Franklin and the physician spent hours conversing on various topics. The acquaintance struck up on this occasion continued as it happened for the rest of Brown's life. Rested, and with his spirits revived, Franklin walked the remaining several miles to Burlington the following morning, a Saturday. To his renewed discouragement, however, he discovered he had just missed the regular packet boat to Philadelphia and that the next would not be leaving until Tuesday. An elderly matron of the village took pity on him, fed him a dinner of ox cheek, and offered to lodge him till the boat came. He accepted the invitation and resigned himself to a long weekend in the hinterlands of New Jersey. But that evening after supper, while stretching his legs by the bank of the Delaware, he spied a boat that appeared to be headed decisively downstream. His inquiries revealed that it was indeed bound for Philadelphia, and yes, there was room for one more. With no time to beg leave of his hostess, he climbed aboard and off they went. The current was nearly slack in this part of the river, and the wind afforded little help. So the young and strong among the passengers took turns at the oars. Franklin, younger and stronger than most, pulled more than his share. They rowed for several hours through the darkness, until some on board wondered whether they had passed their destination by mistake. Tired and uncertain, the rowers refused to pull any more. A collective decision was made to put into shore where several of the passengers started a fire of old fence rails they stumbled upon to ward off the cold of the October night. At daylight, one of them recognized their campsite as being only a short distance above Philadelphia. They wearily clambered back into the boat and finished their voyage, landing early on Sunday morning at the wharf at the foot of Market Street. As Franklin walked up from the dock, the ravages of the South Sea collapse remained everywhere apparent. I saw most of the houses in Walnut Street between 2nd and Front Streets with bills on their doors to be let, he recalled, and many likewise in Chestnut Street and other streets, which made me then think the inhabitants of the city were one after another deserting it. At the time, Franklin couldn't connect the empty houses and shuttered shops with the collapse of the money supply in London. The money supply that worried him was his own. He touched shore in Philadelphia with a single Dutch dollar in his pocket, received in change in New York. He also had a hole in his belly from 4 days on the road and a long night of rowing and shivering. He got his first lesson in imperial economics when he tried to purchase breakfast and discovered to his relief and gratification that one Dutch dollar went further in Philadelphia than it did farther north. Upon meeting a boy carrying a basket of bread, he inquired as to the loaf's provenance. The boy pointed in the direction of 2nd Street. Franklin's hunger-sharpened senses guided him the rest of the way to the bakery. He asked for biscuit, the sort of thing Boston's bakers produced by the barrel for the ship trade. Philadelphia's bakers made nothing of the sort, he was told. He requested a threepenny loaf, in Boston a step up from biscuit. He learned that threepenny loaves were not made in Philadelphia either. At a loss, he asked for threepence worth of whatever they did make in this city. The baker handed him three large, puffy rolls, each the size of the threepenny loaves he had been accustomed to purchase in Boston. The rolls were too big to fit in his pocket, and he had no bag to carry them, customers being expected to supply their own. So he tucked one under his right arm, one under his left, and walked out the door taking large bites from the third. As he proceeded up Market Street, munching his breakfast, he began to feel both conspicuous and out of place. He had not bathed in several days. He was wearing the same clothes that had been soaked by the salt water of the Hudson Estuary and the rain of New Jersey. From his pockets hung dirty stockings, shirts, and underwear. He knew no one in the town nor where he was going. Years later, he remembered the most awkward, ridiculous appearance he made. Another person who evidently thought so was a girl somewhat younger than he, standing in the door of her father's house on the city's main thoroughfare. Ben did not know her name, nor she his, but he noticed her and she him, which made him feel all the more awkward. He turned and headed back toward the river, where at least he had the passing acquaintance of those he had come downstream with, some of whom were continuing on shortly. Although the first roll merely dulled his hunger, he decided to stop advertising his poverty and gave the other two to a woman and her child in the boat. The bread had made him thirsty. He helped himself to water from the river and freshened his face at the same time. By now, the inhabitants of the town were up and about. As a group, they were clean and well-dressed, which again reminded Franklin that he was neither. and as a group they seemed to be walking in a single direction. He fell into step and was carried along to the friends' meeting house. No one questioned him at the door, and he allowed himself to be swept on in. As he had not been a regular at Boston's South Church for years, he may or may not have expected a learned disquisition on the scriptures or a soul-stirring description of the fate that awaited those who spurned God's grace. What he did get was decidedly lower key, in the Quaker fashion. After being up all night and now warm and with at least a little food in his stomach, he soon grew drowsy and fell asleep. His hosts did not take his fatigue amiss. They let him slumber and gently woke him when the service was over. Franklin followed the congregation out and, propelled as much by gravity as by any notion of where he was going, wandered back down toward the waterfront. A friendly-faced young man in the sober dress of a Quaker caught his eye. Franklin inquired as to where a stranger might find lodging. They were standing almost under the sign of the Three Mariners Inn. "How about this place?" he asked. The Quaker replied that strangers did indeed lodge there, but not the sort a decent fellow ought to share a table or a bed with. If Franklin would follow him, he said, employing the these and thous of his sect, he would point out a more reputable establishment. Together they walked a short way to the Crooked Billet on King Street, next to the river. Franklin's morning bread had lost its effect by now, and he ordered dinner. The host and patrons were accustomed to sailors and other strangers, but this one particularly engaged their attention. From his worn and tattered clothing and his beardless, dirty face, he gave every indication of being a runaway. No one challenged him directly. His host was too canny a businessman to allow his patrons to frighten off other paying customers on mere suspicion. But by oblique queries, "Been traveling long? Whither bound?" they probed to discover who might be chasing him and why. Franklin answered civilly but unforthcomingly. He kept his head in his plate and finished his meal as quickly as he decently could. He may have aroused additional suspicion when he asked about a bed where he could sleep the afternoon, and, as it must have seemed, hide out. But no one gainsaid him, and he recouped several hours more of the slumber he had missed the previous two nights. His host roused him for supper, which he ate as discreetly as dinner before returning to bed. He slept the night through, waking the next morning almost as fit as when he had left Boston. As he gathered himself for his interview with Andrew Bradford, Franklin may have reflected that it was a good thing his beard had not yet begun to grow. At least, he didn't need a shave. But he could have used a bath and some clean clothes and breakfast. His money, however, was nearly gone, and he chose to husband what he had. So, without bathing or changing his clothes or eating, he headed off for the printing shop of Bradford the Younger. To his surprise, he was greeted there by Bradford the Elder. William Bradford had practiced his craft in Philadelphia before moving to New York. Now he had returned, on horseback, a more reliable but more expensive mode than Franklin could afford, to see old friends and check on his son. Franklin, after his friendly encounter with the father in New York, doubtless hoped that the older man's presence would work to his benefit. It did, but not to the degree he desired. William Bradford made the introductions, and Andrew appeared favorably disposed, asking Franklin about himself and insisting that he join the two of them for breakfast. Unfortunately, he said he had just engaged a journeyman to replace his untimely departed assistant, and business did not allow adding another hand. He expected some special orders presently. When these arrived, he would need more help and could offer Franklin piecework. But there was another printer in town, he continued, a new man who might well desire a second. Franklin should call on him. If something worked out there, all the good. If not, Franklin was welcome to come back and lodge at the Bradford House till business warranted hiring him. Franklin finished his breakfast and extended thanks for the advice and the offer. As he headed out the door to the other printers, William Bradford accompanied him, saying he would show the boy the way. On arrival, Bradford introduced himself and Franklin to Samuel Keimer. "Neighbor," he said, "here is a young man about your own business. Perhaps you have work for him?" Keimer may have been puzzled as to why this stranger should bring him a second stranger to hire, but he marked it up to the friendliness of the city of brotherly love. A voluble sort, Keimer began telling Bradford his plans for capturing the bulk of the printing business in Pennsylvania. Bradford, not wishing to interrupt the flow of useful intelligence, declined to reveal his own background or his connection to Keimer's only rival. Instead, he drew Keimer out by the artful question and the quizzical glance, till Keimer had divulged his entire business agenda and strategy. Franklin observed the performance with interest and no little admiration. It was apparent to Franklin, though obviously not to Keimer, that one of them was a crafty old sophister and the other a mere novice. What Franklin heard caused him to wonder whether he wished to work for such a novice. What he saw while walking around the shop as Keimer and Bradford talked doubled his doubts. The equipment was far inferior to what he had employed at James's. It consisted of a broken-down press and a single, worn-out font. Keimer was clearly unfamiliar with its operation, and was currently engaged in the woefully inefficient method of composing directly into type, which precluded anyone's assisting him. His project was an elegy to Aquila Rose, Andrew Bradford's late journeyman, whose contributions to local civic life had transcended his print work. Rose operated a ferry on the Schuylkill River, served as clerk of the Colonial Assembly, and wrote well-received poems. If Franklin thought it at all odd that Keimer was eulogizing the former assistant of his rival, the thought simply added to the conception he was forming of Keimer as eccentric. But Franklin needed work and indicated he would be happy with whatever Keimer could offer. Keimer handed Franklin a composing stick and asked him to demonstrate. Impressed by Franklin's efforts, he said he would have work for him soon, although not just now. Franklin put the press into such working order as it was capable of, and said that when Keimer had finished setting the type for the elegy, he would come back and print it. He left, shaking his head, if only to himself. He returned to Andrew Bradford's and took up the invitation to lodge there. In the next few days, Bradford found odd jobs for him, but not so many that when Keimer belatedly accepted his offer to print the Rose elegy, Franklin was inclined to say no. By then, Keimer had acquired additional type and an order for some pamphlets. Together, these allowed him to hire Franklin on a regular basis. Briefly, Franklin continued to live with Bradford while working for Keimer. The arrangement enabled him to form an opinion of the state of the printing craft in Pennsylvania, and he quickly judged it less than he was accustomed to. Bradford was very illiterate, an obvious handicap for one who lived on letters. Keimer was better read and indeed fancied himself a scholar. But in fact, he was very ignorant of the world, including the printer's craft. In addition, he professed a strange variant of French Protestantism, one given to mystical trances and alarming revelations of the messianic age to begin at any moment. Having discovered too late the true identity of William Bradford from Franklin, Keimer was suspicious of spies in his shop, and he announced one day that Franklin must cancel his housing arrangement with his rival or find other work. Franklin would have been happy to find other work had such existed, but none did. He inquired whether he might lodge with Keimer, who owned a house. But though Keimer had a house, he had no furniture and no plans to purchase any. Franklin could not stay with him, he said. Instead, the young man should seek a room with John Reed, a carpenter who lived on Market Street. Franklin presented himself at the Reed house, where he encountered the 15-year-old girl he had noticed, to his embarrassment, on his first morning in Philadelphia. By now, though, his trunk had arrived from New York, and with clean clothes and a few recently earned coins in his pocket, he felt much better able to stand scrutiny by the fair sex. I made rather a more respectable appearance in the eyes of Miss Reed than I had done when she first happened to see me eating my roll in the street. Deborah Reed evidently thought so too, either at once or shortly thereafter. Nor was she alone in her opinion. During the winter of 1724-25, Ben Franklin began forming a circle of friends, acquaintances, and admirers. He was a pleasant-looking young man, with a broad forehead, firm nose, and square jaw. On the tall side of average, he was thick through the shoulders and chest. His eyes were lucid, suggesting a lively intelligence. His well-formed mouth pursed when he was concentrating, but smiled easily and often, revealing an equally well-formed sense of humor. His self-confidence, never lacking, had grown since his arrival in Philadelphia. Having measured himself against the printers of a second city, he appreciated his skills more than ever. As much to the point, he had discovered, as every young person does who successfully leaves home, that he could make his way in the world. His native intelligence and common sense served him well, so too the social skills absorbed in the crowded bosom of the family he had left behind. The former gifts gave him the ascendancy in nearly any group he joined. The latter prevented that ascendancy from annoying any but the most envious in the group. As was the case throughout the American colonies, the population of Philadelphia was growing rapidly, and had been for some time. One result was the large number of young people Franklin found to socialize with. His work with Keimer threw him into contact with the more literary-minded of the city. He was delighted to find a cohort of contemporaries who shared his interest in reading, questioning, and exploring the life of the mind generally. They debated topics classical and literary, current and political. Most were just starting on careers in the crafts or professions. Few had much more to spend on books or beer than Franklin did. So they swapped books as they swapped arguments. And as long as they enlivened the conversation at one tavern or another, the proprietors didn't mind that they nursed their glasses longer than was strictly profitable. In feudal times arose a saying that city air made a man free. Franklin certainly felt that way during his first winter in Philadelphia. To be sure, Philadelphia was no more a city than Boston, but in Boston he had borne the double burden of Puritan clerisy and sibling jealousy. The tolerant spirit of William Penn still protected Penn's city half a decade after his death. And to a person of Franklin's questioning temperament, it was infinitely more congenial than the forced certitude of the Mathers. If Franklin was pleased to put Puritanism behind him, he was no less happy to be beyond the reach of his brother James. With James, Ben's life had always been an emotional and sometimes a physical struggle. Ben was smarter than James and more talented, as James and Ben both knew. James had resented this, and in his resentment insisted on his prerogatives as master, not to mention older brother, all the more. But James's insistence backfired. Ben, as the younger brother, naturally had to assert his independence. James's attempts to suppress that independence simply provoked Ben to rebellion. Keimer was not half the printer James was. But because Ben's relationship with Keimer was strictly business, he could accept his boss's odd ways for the harmless idiosyncrasies they were. Acceding to idiosyncrasy for the sake of wages did not touch Ben's self-esteem the way bending to brotherly dictate had. As a result, Franklin's first winter in Philadelphia marked a vast improvement over recent circumstances in the city of his birth. I lived very agreeably, forgetting Boston as much as I could, and not desiring that any there should know where I resided, except my friend Collins, who was in my secret and kept it when I wrote to him. By chance, a brother-in-law, Robert Holmes, who sailed a commercial sloop between Massachusetts and the Delaware region, heard that his wife's brother had landed in Philadelphia. Holmes wrote Franklin a letter explaining the family's distress at his disappearance and assuring him that all would be put right if he returned to Boston. Ben didn't question Holmes's worthy intentions, but he replied that he had left Boston for good cause, was quite happy in Philadelphia, and had not the slightest desire to go back. Yet this 17-year-old master of his fate discovered he was not so independent as he thought. On the day Robert Holmes received Franklin's letter at Newcastle, Delaware, the provincial governor of Pennsylvania, William Keith, happened to be present. Captain Holmes evidently made some remark about Franklin, perhaps about the boy's obduracy, and shared the letter with the governor. Keith was surprised and impressed to learn that the author of the letter was not even a man yet. Keith had arrived independently at the same opinion Franklin was forming of Philadelphia's two printers, that they were a sorry pair for a province of promise and ambition. On the spot, apparently, Keith conceived a plan to keep Franklin in Philadelphia and encourage him in his craft. The governor returned to Philadelphia and paid a visit to Keimer's print shop. Keimer and Franklin were working together in the window of the shop. Both saw the governor and an obviously important friend approaching from across the street. Keimer had been hoping to win the official business of the province. Here it came, he thought. He greeted the governor and the friend at the door and invited them in. To his chagrin, they scarcely acknowledged him, instead seeking out Franklin. The governor belatedly welcomed Franklin to Philadelphia, kindly blamed him for hiding in the print shop and not presenting himself at the governor's house, praised his skill and intelligence, and invited him to join Colonel John French of Delaware and himself for a glass of excellent Madeira kept by the proprietor of a tavern just down the street. Franklin wondered at the cause of this benign attention. His boss was stunned. Keimer stared like a pig poisoned, Franklin recalled. Over the wine, the governor again praised Franklin's gifts and urged him to start his own printing business. Such a venture, he said, would have every chance of success, including his own support in procuring the public business of the province. Colonel French endorsed the governor's comments and added, in tones that sounded authoritative, that he would similarly recommend that Franklin receive the public printing business of Delaware. Delaware, at this time, was administratively attached to Pennsylvania under a 1682 lease of 10,000 years' duration from the Duke of York to William Penn. The lower counties, as Delaware was called by Pennsylvanians, had their own legislature and executive council, but shared Pennsylvania's governor, currently Keith. The notion of his own print shop certainly had occurred to Franklin, probably as soon as he sized up Bradford and Keimer. He may or may not have asked himself why Philadelphia was so deficient in the printing and allied trades. He hadn't been in town long enough to agree or disagree with the opinion given some years earlier by one disgusted scholar. The reason there are no bookbinders here, where all sorts of other craftsmen are found, is that there is no scholarship here, and nothing counts but chopping, digging, planting, plowing, reaping. Even at first glance, Franklin could tell that the printed word mattered less in Philadelphia than in Boston. But that might simply reflect the deficiencies of the local printers. An enterprising and talented young man need not be discouraged by present conditions. Such, at any rate, was the expressed opinion of Governor Keith, who was placed to know. Franklin didn't doubt his own talents, but he painfully felt his lack of capital. Without money for a press and related equipment, not even the most gifted printer could set up shop. At his present pay, he might put aside sufficient funds to purchase equipment in several years, but hardly before then. An older man with an established reputation might borrow money, but who would lend to a lad just arrived from distant parts? A lad who, as the governor evidently knew from Robert Holmes, had fled his contractual obligations there. Keith conceded that capital was a problem. Perhaps a relative could supply the initial funds? How about Franklin's father? Franklin was dubious. He had no desire to return to Boston, certainly not to ask for money. For all he knew, James might try to enforce the apprentice agreement, out of jealousy, if nothing else. But Keith refused to be deterred by Franklin's family problems. He offered to write Josiah Franklin a letter laying out the plan he had just described and underscoring the bright prospects of the venture. Surely no father would deny his son the chance to pursue such an opportunity. The governor's enthusiasm proved infectious. Reflecting, Franklin could scarcely believe his good fortune. Only weeks before, he had hauled himself up on Philadelphia's wharf, hungry, ragged, and all but penniless, a runaway apprentice. Now the governor of Pennsylvania and another man who evidently spoke for Delaware were promising every assistance in the establishment of his own print shop. How could his father say no? Franklin agreed to make the request. Winter weather had suspended most shipping to New England, but come spring he would take the first vessel for Boston. Meanwhile, as Keith suggested, prudence dictated keeping their plan to themselves. Otherwise, Franklin might run into trouble with his employer. Franklin returned to Keimer's shop, where his still-stunned boss queried him as to what he and the governor had spoken of. "Nothing of importance," Franklin replied. "The governor was simply being polite." Keimer probably doubted he was hearing the whole story, and his doubts likely increased during the next several weeks, when Franklin accepted several invitations to dine with the governor. Franklin did not share with his employer how Keith conversed with him in the most affable, familiar, and friendly manner imaginable, and certainly not how the governor reiterated his support for an independent Franklin shop. If Keimer suspected that competition was afoot, he suppressed his suspicions sufficiently to keep Franklin on. The boy was a good printer and could not easily be replaced. By the time the shipping lanes reopened in April 1724, Franklin was more than ready to sail for Boston. His return voyage proved less eventful than his departing voyage had been, although the vessel he sailed on hit a shoal going down the Delaware Bay and began taking on water. The captain declined to stop for repairs, instead putting the pumps to work and putting the passengers to the pumps. Franklin did not begrudge the exercise, which warmed him against the chill of the North Atlantic spring. After 2 weeks, they spied the heights of Beacon Hill. After a few more hours, they landed at the Boston waterfront. Franklin had been gone 7 months. And because Robert Holmes had not been back since discovering his presence in Philadelphia, none of his family or friends, with the exception of the discreet Collins, had any idea where he was, or even if he was alive. To some considerable degree, his deliverance from the dead, as it appeared, absolved him of whatever guilt remained from his running away. His father and mother embraced him. His siblings marveled at his fine suit of clothes, his watch and fob, and the pocketful of silver he dispensed so freely. If such was Philadelphia, it must be a fine place. The conspicuous exception to the general delight over the return of the runaway was James. Having resented Ben's talents, now he envied him his success. "He received me not very frankly," Ben noted, "looked me all over, and turned to his work again." James's journeymen were more inquisitive. They wanted to know all about Philadelphia, what life was like there, whether printers found employment. When they asked what wages working men made in Pennsylvania, Ben spread his silver coins before them. Such solid currency was rare in Boston, where paper notes were the norm. He displayed his watch, impressing them the more, and then gave them a piece of eight to drink his health. James, across the room, affected not to notice. But to Ben, he seemed grum and sullen, and, as Ben heard from his mother later, felt so insulted at Ben's carrying on in front of his workers that he could never forgive the offense. When Ben broached to his father the purpose of his visit, producing the letter from Governor Keith extolling Ben's talents and prospects and forecasting wonderful success for the printing venture, Josiah couldn't help feeling proud. Imagine such an exalted personage taking an interest in his boy. But having worked long for his money, he was loath to part with it lightly. He asked himself, then asked Robert Holmes when the latter arrived in Boston, what sort of person, governor or no, would have him place such faith in a boy still 3 years from legal manhood? Holmes could not entirely vouch for Keith's judgment, but said what he could in favor of Ben and the project. Yet Josiah would not be moved. He wrote a letter to Keith expressing gratitude for the patronage the governor was offering his son, but said the money involved and the responsibilities to be incurred were more than should be placed on the shoulders of a boy. All the same, he did not leave Ben bereft. He had hoped for a reconciliation between Ben and James. Seeing the impossibility of this, he granted Ben his paternal blessing to return to Philadelphia. He enjoined his youngest son to work diligently and keep a rein on his rebellious streak. If Ben stuck to his task for 3 years and lived frugally, he would be able to save most of what he needed to establish himself in business. If at that time he fell short, he should come back to Boston for the balance. This was less than Ben wanted, but more than he had a right, or reason really, knowing his father, to expect. When he left his parents' house now, he did so in the light of day and full public view. James remained angry, but the rest of the family wished him Godspeed and continued success. He also received a parting gift from Cotton Mather. To Franklin's surprise, the minister evinced a desire to see the young man. Franklin visited his library, where Mather indicated that all was forgiven. But not quite forgotten. On showing Franklin out via a side passage, he suddenly said, "Stoop! Stoop!" Franklin didn't understand him and ran into a low beam. Never one to let a sermonizing moment pass, Mather explained, "You are young and have the world before you. Stoop as you go through it, and you will miss many hard thumps." Franklin's education in life continued on the journey south. His sloop called at New York, where his Boston friend John Collins awaited him. Collins, having seen how Franklin prospered in Pennsylvania, had determined to join him in the city of the Friends. Collins traveled overland to New York, where he joined Franklin for the rest of the trip. Franklin had known Collins as an industrious and sober scholar, but lately his friend had acquired a taste for brandy. Like many another young man suddenly unsupervised in unfamiliar surroundings, Collins found his freedom more than he could manage. He descended into a state of constant inebriation. He compounded his problem by frequent visits to gaming tables. When Franklin reached New York, he found his friend drunk, broke, and just ahead of the sheriff. Franklin paid Collins's bills and resigned himself to paying the rest of Collins's way to Philadelphia. Despite his friend's antics, Franklin's New York stopover wasn't a dead loss. On this trip south, Franklin was transporting some books he had left behind in Boston when he departed covertly the previous year. He was also carrying Collins's small library. The captain of the sloop evidently did not have regular contacts with bookish types, and in a casual conversation with William Burnett, the governor jointly of New York and New Jersey, he remarked on his learned passenger. The governor, himself a scholar, and feeling isolated in an intellectual wasteland, invited Franklin to pay him a visit. Franklin was flattered at this attention from another governor, and he accepted the invitation with pleasure. The two conversed about books and authors. The governor doubtless had his favorable, indirect impression of Franklin confirmed firsthand. Upon arrival in Philadelphia, Collins continued to cost Franklin. Collins's alcoholic habit prevented his obtaining employment, and Franklin saw no alternative to paying his room and board till his circumstances improved. Unfortunately, they did not. Collins found new gambling partners among the Pennsylvanians and ran into debt again. He pleaded with Franklin for loans, which Franklin provided against his better judgment. Franklin lectured Collins to mend his affairs. Collins told him to mind his own. Sharp words gave way to physical violence on at least one occasion. Franklin and Collins were in a boat on the Delaware River with some other young men. Collins was drunk as usual. When it came his turn to row, he refused. He was in no shape to pull an oar, he said. Franklin declared hotly that he must row, as everyone else had done. Collins replied that he would not. They could spend the entire night on the water for all he cared. The others in the boat told Franklin to let it go. They simply wanted to get home. But Franklin would not drop the matter, nor would he let the others row. Collins thereupon took the offensive. Vowing to throw Franklin overboard, he charged at his friend. Franklin sidestepped the attack, grabbed Collins under the crotch, and hurled him headlong into the river. This sobered him only slightly, for as he swam back toward the boat, he responded to queries as to whether he would finally agree to row by cursing them all and declaring he would never do so. Franklin, happy enough now to take an oar, pulled the boat beyond Collins's reach. Again, those in the boat asked whether Collins would row. Again, he profanely refused. Again, Franklin pulled the boat ahead of Collins. This continued for some time. Eventually, fearing that Collins might drown, the others convinced Franklin to let him be hauled up. This episode ended what was left of the friendship. Not long afterward, Collins shipped out to Barbados to serve as tutor to the sons of a planter there. In one of his rare clear-headed and remorseful moments, he promised to pay Franklin what he owed him with the first money he received in his new post. But he never did, and Franklin never heard from him again. William Keith was disappointed on learning of Josiah Franklin's refusal to stake his son as a printer. The old man was entirely too cautious, Keith said. Mere youth was no warrant of indiscretion, financial or otherwise, just as age was no guarantee of judgment. Perhaps afraid that Philadelphia would lose this bright lad, perhaps swept away by his own vision and magnanimity, Keith declared that if Josiah Franklin of Boston would not back his boy, William Keith of Philadelphia would. Pennsylvania needed printers, and the governor would see that it got them. He told Franklin to draw up a list of the equipment and supplies he would require from England, and they would be ordered at once. Franklin could repay the debt when he was able. The important thing was to put the project in motion. Franklin's head had been turned by Keith's previous solicitude, then turned further by the flattering attention of Governor Burnett. Now this offer sent it fairly spinning. The greatest man of the city and the province was putting his own money into a venture whose sole source of promise was the intelligence and skill of 18-year-old Ben Franklin. The young man's future was assured. Philadelphia was a wonderful city. Walking home from this interview, Franklin began calculating what he would require to commence business. A quick tally brought the total to £100. Keith found the inventory entirely acceptable when Franklin explained it. He asked in a manner that presupposed a positive answer, whether the venture would benefit from Franklin's presence in London when the fonts and other items were selected. Besides, he intimated, Pennsylvania's leading printer must make acquaintances among his counterparts in the imperial capital. The outset of the project was the obvious occasion to do so. Franklin could sail in the autumn on the annual ship, at provincial expense, of course. Once more, Franklin was amazed at how marvelously his career was progressing. The governor had endorsed his business judgment by accepting his proposal. Now he was sending him off to London as the all but official printer of the province. To be sure, the ship wouldn't be sailing for some months, but that would simply allow time to perfect his plans. Frustratingly, he could not share those plans with anyone, least of all Keimer, with whom he continued to spend his working hours. "He suspected nothing of my setting up," Franklin later asserted. One wonders. Franklin paid frequent visits to the governor's house. Keimer must have asked himself, although he apparently did not ask Franklin, what the young man and the governor talked about. Further, Franklin was obviously too talented to remain a journeyman forever. Unless he relocated again, he must one day set himself up as Keimer's competitor. Quite possibly, Keimer thought he could keep Franklin till the boy turned 21. Only then would Franklin be fully able to conclude contracts and do all the other things necessary to direct a business. And it was entirely possible Keimer thought he himself might be out of the printing business by that time. Other enthusiasms beckoned. Foremost of these was a dream to found a new religious sect, one that embodied his own peculiar interpretation of the scriptures. Keimer loved disputation. Since Franklin did too, the pair spent many hours over their frame and fonts, arguing the finer points of theology and philosophy. Franklin employed the indirect style he had learned in Boston and regularly used it to tie Keimer in intellectual knots. Keimer eventually discovered the equally venerable rhetorical device of refusing to accept any premise whatever, in his case from a plausible fear Franklin would find a devious path from premise to refutation. Whether or not the experience shook Keimer's beliefs, it heightened his regard for Franklin's forensic skills. He offered Franklin a place next to the throne in his new order. Keimer would dispense doctrine. Franklin would defend it by confounding their opponents. To himself, Franklin laughed at Keimer's delusions. The more easily now that he saw the terminus of his dependence on his employer approaching. To Keimer, he put on a grave face and indicated he was flattered at the invitation, but wondered if he might have some say about the sect's practices. A vegetarian diet, for example, would benefit both body and soul. Keimer was skeptical, but when Franklin agreed to accept Keimer's teaching on the proper observance of the Sabbath, Saturday instead of Sunday, and the Levitican ban on cropping beards, prospectively a problem once Franklin's whiskers started seriously growing, but not yet, the elder man agreed to give vegetarianism a test. Franklin supplied a neighbor woman with a list of 40 dishes containing neither meat nor fish nor fowl. For 18 pence per week, she would cook from this list. Franklin experienced no difficulty reacquainting himself with a non-sanguinary regime, but Keimer suffered, as Franklin knew he would. He was usually a great glutton, and I promised myself some diversion in half-starving him. For 3 months, Keimer held out, dreaming day and night of beefsteaks, lamb chops, and fried ham. Though the spirit remained willing, the flesh finally succumbed. He ordered a roast suckling pig and invited Franklin and two women friends to celebrate his delivery from this ill-advised experiment. But the pig arrived before the guests did, and Keimer, unable to wait 15 minutes more, ate the whole thing himself. Keimer was not the only person who found himself the object of Franklin's amusements. Collins having departed in disgrace, Franklin devoted more time to his Philadelphia friends. Three in particular, Charles Osborne, Joseph Watson, and James Ralph, formed his literary circle. The group met regularly for Sunday walks. These provided a peripatetic forum for discussions of this author or that. Occasionally, one or another would produce a piece of writing and submit it to the group for critique. Of the four, James Ralph had the highest ambitions for a career in writing, poetry to be specific. Charles Osborne likewise had poetic pretensions, but he also possessed the askant eye of the critic, especially toward Ralph's poetry and hopes of making a living by it. Franklin, recalling his own humbling efforts at versifying, shared Osborne's opinion that a career in poetry was a fool's quest, although he allowed that if Ralph wanted to write poetry merely to please himself, that was his affair. Franklin added the opinion he had formed some years earlier that even poetry that did not rise to art could serve as a tool for the improvement of one's prose. The others concurred in this sensible opinion, and an assignment, setting the 18th psalm to verse, was agreed upon. Just before the next meeting, Ralph approached Franklin, his updating of David in hand. Franklin read the piece and registered approval. Ralph thereupon asked him to take part in a deception. Osborne, Ralph complained, would never say anything positive about his, Ralph's, poetry. He couldn't stand that someone, specifically Ralph, might write more gracefully than he. Would Franklin be willing to present Ralph's piece as his own? Only by such a subterfuge could Ralph get an objective opinion. Franklin's schedule at Keimer's that week had prevented his writing a poem himself, and he consented. He cribbed Ralph's work into his own hand and read it to the group. Osborne praised it extravagantly. Ralph suggested a few revisions. Osborne told him he was as dull a critic as a poet and didn't know what he was talking about. After the meeting, while Osborne and Ralph were walking home together, the former continued to effuse over the purported Franklin poem. Such imagery! Such power! He confided to Ralph that he had not earlier praised the piece as fully as he might have. He didn't want to seem a flatterer. He wondered aloud how a person who spoke so indifferently could write with such passion and fire. The confusion provoked laughter at Osborne's expense when the ruse was revealed at the next meeting. The episode did not estrange Osborne from Franklin. The two remained friendly enough to pledge a pact that whichever of them predeceased the other should, after having surveyed the ground on that farther shore, return and apprise the living one of the landscape there. The obligation fell to Osborne, who died relatively young. He never fulfilled his promise, Franklin noted at 65. Debating with his friends and dreaming of his future success filled most of Franklin's leisure time during that summer of his 19th year, but not all. Love occupied him as well. The object of his affections was Deborah Reed, with whom he had grown increasingly familiar since that inauspicious morning of his arrival the previous autumn. She had watched his career prospects improve with Keimer. Partly in consequence, he saw his romantic prospects improve with her. 10 months earlier, unknown and unemployed, he was the sort no father would have let near his daughter. Now, well-placed in his craft, surrounded by friends hard-working and respectable, and waited upon by Governor Keith, he was one of the more eligible young men in town. Precisely what Franklin saw in Deborah Reed is more difficult to discern. No one painted her portrait during that period, and the only surviving one from later years shows a woman with a not unpleasant but neither notably appealing face. She was 2 years younger than he, which especially in that age meant that she might physically have been hardly more than a girl. Yet he seems to have been quite attracted to her, for they spoke of marriage. Her father and mother did not dismiss the idea. They had been searching for a good match, not least because John Reed had lately run into financial difficulties. The search grew more pressing that September when Reed suddenly died, leaving his debts and his daughter, among other children, to his wife. At this point, Sarah Reed must have listened carefully as Ben Franklin made his suit. Yet careful she was, and reflecting on Ben's youth, she told them to wait until his return from England. Perhaps she wished to gauge the seriousness of his intentions. Perhaps she wished to see whether the print shop he spoke of with great enthusiasm, to Debbie and her, yet still to almost no one else, actually materialized. Her husband's money troubles had resulted from his lending credence and cash to glib retailers of fraudulent promises. A modest skepticism would become his widow and safeguard his daughter. Franklin could not gainsay this prudence in a mother-in-law. Nor was there much he could do about it if he had, for Sarah Reed was not the sort to be trifled with. Love would have to wait the 6 months or so the crossing to England and the return would require. Then he would be older, and with printing equipment in hand, his success would be assured. At that point, Sarah Reed could not deny him, and Debbie would not. Chapter 3. London Once, 1724 to 1726. It is a truism that one travels to learn about home, but Franklin was young, and consequently it came as a surprise that the most important lesson he learned in going to London was what sort of person William Keith was. The lesson commenced before his ship cleared the Delaware River. Right down to the dock, the governor continued to pledge full support for Franklin's printing project. He would provide not merely the letter of credit for the £100 Franklin's inventory required, but reference letters to friends well-placed to see the project profitably started. Repeatedly, Franklin called at the governor's house to receive the letters. Repeatedly, he was told that the demands of duty had prevented the governor from drafting them. Come again next week, and they would definitely be ready. He did. They were not. He did again. They were not. Understandably, he began to worry. As luck would have it, the departure of the annual ship was several times postponed. Though this afforded more time for the governor to fulfill his pledge, it threw a cloud of additional uncertainty over the entire venture. Finally, on November 5, 1724, the London Hope cast off and drifted down the Delaware. The governor's promised letters still had not appeared. Franklin boarded at the last moment only on the express assurance of the governor's personal secretary that the letters would be supplied at Newcastle, a downstream destination for which the governor himself was about to depart and which he would reach before the ship did. Even as the ship was tying up at Newcastle, Franklin leaped ashore in search of the governor. Once more, the governor's secretary intercepted him, saying again, the governor was extremely busy, but he would include the letters with the rest of the official correspondence to be loaded at the last moment. This seemed a plausible, if not persuasive, explanation, and was made the more so when Colonel French, the governor's Delaware friend, personally carried the official packet aboard. He greeted Franklin warmly. This had the double effect of reassuring Franklin about Keith's bona fides and elevating the young man in the opinion of the other passengers, who heretofore had deemed him unworthy of notice. He would have been even more reassured had he been allowed to see the letters, but the captain, concerned that their numerous delays would place them in mid-Atlantic when the gales of winter began to blow, refused to risk any further delay. Franklin could not go through the packet now. But if he would be patient, he would have any letters meant for his hand long before they landed at London. "I was satisfied for the present," Franklin recalled, "and we proceeded on our voyage." Franklin's first ocean crossing was a tempestuous one. The winter weather did indeed catch them out. Wind, rain, sleet, and snow battered the vessel and kept the passengers below decks most of the way. To his satisfaction, and as it turned out his lifelong convenience, Franklin discovered that stormy seas had little effect on his stomach or head. He employed the time and the close quarters to improve his acquaintance with certain individuals who had taken notice of him when Colonel French did. Indeed, these men called him out of steerage to berth with them in the cabin. They shared their victuals and all made merry together. "We had a sociable company," Franklin said, "and lived uncommonly well." As the craft entered the English Channel, the captain kept his promise and allowed Franklin to sort through the Pennsylvania pouch. To his surprise, he found no letters bearing his name. Thinking this an oversight, he selected several addressed to individuals evidently connected to the governor's pledge and to the errand that had brought him hither. One such letter was to the king's printer, another to a London stationer. Franklin could not well open the letters and discover for certain, but he assumed that the governor therein explained this fine young man's mission and pledged political and financial support. Upon landing at London on Christmas Eve of 1724, Franklin looked up the addressees. The first he chanced upon was the stationer, to whom he delivered the missive as from Governor Keith. The stationer looked puzzled. "I don't know the man," he said, thereby puzzling Franklin. Opening the letter, the stationer exclaimed, "Oh, this is from Riddlesden." William Riddlesden, as Franklin probably did not know, was a convicted felon who had been transported to Maryland in lieu of prison. As Franklin knew full well, Riddlesden had continued in his conniving ways in America, sucking John Reed into one of his confidence schemes to the persisting detriment of Sarah and their children. The Maryland Assembly had conferred upon him the distinction of being officially proclaimed a person of a matchless character in infamy. This opinion was shared by the stationer, who now read the letter Franklin delivered. "I have lately found him to be a complete rascal," he said, in Franklin's reconstruction of the conversation, "and I will have nothing to do with him, nor receive any letters from him." With this, he thrust the letter back into Franklin's hand and turned to greet a customer. As he left the stationer's shop, Franklin looked closely at the other letters. He realized that these were not from the governor either. For the first time, he began seriously to doubt whether the mailbag contained any letters from Keith on his behalf, or even whether Keith had ever intended to write any such letters. Consulting Thomas Denham, one of his cabin mates and a prosperous Pennsylvania merchant who had known Keith for some time, Franklin learned that the governor had a habit of promising much and delivering little. Denham laughed aloud when Franklin mentioned the letter of credit Keith was to have sent. "Sir William," Denham said, "had no credit to give." This lesson in human nature came as a shock. When he had awakened that morning, Franklin fancied himself an independent artisan about to embark on a brilliant career. Now he was simply an out-of-work journeyman a very long way from home, with no place to stay and no friends within 3,000 miles. Actually, he did have one friend, although this friend soon proved more trouble than any enemy. James Ralph had accompanied Franklin to London. Determined, after his success in the small charade he and Franklin had committed against Charles Osborne, to seek artistic fame in the capital of English letters. He did not confide his plans to his wife, who remained in Philadelphia with their small child. Instead, he told her he was going to London to establish commercial connections that would allow him to set up a merchandising business upon his return. She and her relatives doubtless deemed this an improvement over idle versifying and bade him bon voyage. But no sooner had the London Hope arrived at the city of its name than Ralph informed Franklin he wasn't going back. He could not abide his in-laws, he said. His future lay in England. Disappointingly for Ralph and unluckily for Franklin, that future was slow to unfold. He initially thought to broaden from written art to performance. Approaching a local theater troupe, he inquired about acting. The director auditioned him briefly before pronouncing that literature could not spare his gifts. Ralph thereupon proposed to write a weekly paper, a competitor to The Spectator, for a rival publisher. The publisher, however, could not be convinced that Ralph's talent warranted the terms he was demanding. Ralph lowered his sights again, applying for work as a clerk and copyist for the stationers and lawyers who crowded London's Temple District. He was told no openings existed. Ralph had arrived in London with empty pockets, having spent his last on the passage from America. His failure to find work extended his impecunious period. So he imposed on Franklin to underwrite his portion of a room they shared on the street called Little Britain, to the north of St. Paul's Cathedral. One of their neighbors was a young woman they both found attractive. Ralph, the older and more worldly of the two, beat Franklin to her favors. When she moved to other quarters, Ralph moved in with her. For a time, he lived off her earnings as a milliner. But when these proved insufficient to support him, her, and her young daughter, he resolved once more to get work. He advertised himself as a schoolmaster, and indeed set up an establishment of learning in the countryside in Berkshire. He acquired some dozen pupils, a modest income, and a new name. He had not abandoned his literary ambitions, and evidently fearing that such a low post as schoolmaster might be held against a budding genius, he borrowed his friend's name. Franklin learned this fact upon receiving a letter from Ralph, in which the latter explained his circumstances and requested that any reply be addressed to Mr. Franklin, schoolmaster. His family name was common enough that Franklin didn't feel obliged to object to its borrowing, any more than he had objected to Ralph's borrowing of his money. He calculated that he would eventually get his name back. As for the money, that seemed to have slipped down the same hole that had swallowed the generosity he extended to John Collins. Yet Ralph was not without collateral of sorts. His absence in Berkshire left his paramour, the Madame Milliner, in distress both emotional and financial. Her relationship with Ralph had cost her friends and a job. She knew Franklin as an easy mark for a hard tale. With tears, sighs, and doubtless the well-timed coquettish glance, she took up where Ralph had left off fishing in Franklin's purse. Yet Franklin was not a complete naïf, at least not on this point. He favored her request for money, then made a request of his own. As he phrased it later, "Presuming on my importance to her, I attempted familiarities." The vigor of his attempt exceeded its welcome. The initiative was repulsed with a proper resentment, forcing Franklin to withdraw. The miscue cost him more than embarrassment. The woman informed Ralph of the real Mr. Franklin's improper advance, prompting Ralph to declare his friendship with Franklin ended and his financial obligations canceled. Franklin felt himself in no position to make an issue of his loss. As he was learning to do, he philosophized that this was all for the best. He never would have seen the money anyway. Nothing had been sacrificed save his good reputation in the eyes of a woman whose own reputation was hardly the finest, and of a friend who was no true friend. In the loss of his friendship, Franklin concluded of Ralph, I found myself relieved from a burden. With almost equal ease, Franklin dispensed with the burden of his relationship with Deborah Reed. Perhaps his eyes were opened by Ralph's flippant abandonment of his wife and child. Perhaps the allure of the milliner's distracted him. Perhaps London simply enticed him in a way staid Philadelphia never had. Certainly he was stunned by his abrupt return to poverty. After the promises, explicit or otherwise, he had made about his imminent success, he probably did not want to face Sarah Reed, let alone Debbie. Finally, as much of his adult life would demonstrate, Franklin possessed a lively libido, which now hindered faithfulness to one so far away when other females were close at hand. Debbie soon slipped from his mind. During his entire stay, he wrote her only once, and then merely to inform her that he would not be returning soon. London, in the early 18th century, was enough to turn the head of any young man. The city that would play a central role in Franklin's life still carried scars and memories from its twin scourges of the 1660s, the plague and the Great Fire. Puritan types, the Cotton Mathers who stayed in Old England, attributed the pestilence and the Holocaust to the ungodly and often downright lewd celebrations that greeted the restoration of the Stuarts after the death of the Lord Protector, Oliver Cromwell. The plague began during the spring of 1665. Creeping out of the slums of the city and spreading silently, except for the wailing of friends and relatives before they themselves succumbed, across every district and neighborhood. By summer, thousands of men, women, and children were dying each week. Those who could fled the city for the countryside in hopes of eluding the invisible destroyer. Isaac Newton, sitting out the plague in Woolsthorpe, watched an apple fall from a tree and extrapolated its trajectory into a theory of universal gravitation. Persons too poor to leave kept to their houses, fearing contact with carriers of the disease. Taverns, inns, and theaters were closed by decree of the frantic civic authorities. A curfew reinforced the popular desire to avoid unnecessary contact with anyone who might be a carrier. 100,000 souls went to their reward, and grass was growing in the streets by the time the Great Fire of 1666 brought the plague to an end. The sight of this new disaster turned discouragement to despair. Oh, the miserable and calamitous spectacle! Such as happily the world had not seen the like since the foundation of it, nor be outdone till the universal conflagration of it, wrote an eyewitness. All the sky was of a fiery aspect, like the top of a burning oven, and the light seen above 40 miles round about for many nights. God grant mine eyes may never behold the like, who now saw above 10,000 houses, all in one flame. The noise and cracking and thunder of the impetuous flames, the shrieking of women and children, the hurry of people, the fall of towers, houses, and churches was like an hideous storm, and the air all about so hot and inflamed that at the last one was not able to approach it. The stones of Paul's flew like grenadoes, the melting lead running down the streets in a stream, and the very pavements glowing with fiery redness. Its horrible destructiveness apart, the fire had two positive consequences. The first was the sterilization of the city against the plague, in what was an inadvertent and extreme but nonetheless successful application of the principle of burning down the house to get rid of the rats. The second was the creation of an elaborate system of men and machines to fight future fires. As Daniel Defoe observed in his Tour Through the Whole Island of Great Britain, written during the period of Franklin's stay in England, no city in the world is so well furnished for the extinguishing fires when they happen. Trained firemen, organized into squadrons with special uniforms and insignias, operated pumping engines that drew water from the Thames and other streams and directed it through hoses onto the flames. Iron hooks on ropes were employed to pull down burning buildings. In stubborn cases, gunpowder was detonated to blast the fuel beyond the fire's reach. The performance of the firefighters obviously impressed Franklin, who, after his return to Philadelphia, set about organizing similar crews. Other aspects of city life were less worthy of imitation, but hardly less fascinating to a lad from the provinces. London afforded endless amusements, some innocuous, others dangerous, still others indicative of the often brutal nature of life in that era. In the category of the at least potentially harmful to body and perhaps to soul, were the prostitutes who put in the shade any on offer in Philadelphia, let alone Boston. As we stumbled along, wrote a chronicler of the period, my friend bid me take notice of a shop wherein sat three or four very provoking damsels, with as much velvet on their backs as would have made a burying pall for a country parish or a holiday coat for a physician. being glorified at bottom with gold fringes, that I thought at first they might be parsons' daughters, who had borrowed their father's pulpit clothes to use as scarves and go a visiting in. Each with as many patches in her marketplace as are spots in a leopard's skin or freckles in the face of a Scotchman. The writer inquired of his friend who or what these ladies were. He answered that they were a kind of first-rate punks by their rigging of about a guinea purchase. The writer asked his friend how he knew they were prostitutes. Lechery layers was the term he used. He replied, because they were sitting in a headdresser's shop, which he says is as seldom to be found without a whore as a bookseller's shop in Paul's churchyard without a parson. Leisured gentlemen partook of the services of such entrepreneurs of intimacy. When satisfied in this regard, they might, along with persons of lesser means, seek diversion at the justice court at Bridewell, where they would watch assorted transgressors, including women and girls, being flogged for their poverty and related misdeeds. Another favorite stop was the Royal Hospital at Bedlam, a corruption in at least two regards of Bethlehem, where guests would laugh at the antics of the lunatics. So popular was mental illness as a spectator sport that rules for visitors had to be posted. No person do give the inmate strong drink, wine, tobacco, or spirits, nor be permitted to sell any such thing in the hospital. Public pillories at Charing Cross and executions at Newgate drew consistent and enthusiastic crowds. Persons unlucky enough to miss the judicial killings could examine the decorporated heads displayed on Temple Bar, otherwise known as London's Golgotha. Spectators who preferred their cruelty inflicted on non-human species could take in the combat among various animals at Hockley in the Hole. A handbill forecast the fun. This is to give notice to all gentlemen, gamesters, and others that on this present Monday is a match to be fought by two dogs, one from Newgate Market against one from Honey Lane Market. Likewise, a green bull to be baited, which was never baited before, and a bull to be turned loose with fireworks all over him. Also, a mad ass to be baited, with variety of bull baiting and bear baiting, and a dog to be drawn up with fireworks, beginning exactly at 3 o'clock. Even unintentionally, London life could be cruel. At inns and public houses, the guests ate out of a common dish. Armed with their own cutlery, they speared for the choicest morsels on what occasionally turned out to be a first-come, first-severed basis. The Grub Street Journal reported, "Last Wednesday, a gentleman met with an odd accident in helping himself to some roast chicken. He found that he had conveyed two joints of another gentleman's forefinger to his plate, together with the wing which he had just taken off." That the digit-deprived gentleman didn't complain more loudly may have owed to the anesthetizing effect of the alcohol in which Londoners swam from morning till night. Like all large cities, London suffered serious problems of public sanitation. Exemplified perhaps most odiously, though hardly uniquely, by the Fleet River, which ran as an open sewer to the Thames. The authorities regularly railed against the popular habit of discharging human, animal, and vegetable waste into the stream. That they had to do so on such a regular basis betrayed their lack of success at compelling compliance. Not until the 1760s was the problem solved, or at least covered over, when the Fleet River became Fleet Street. Partly as a health measure, to avoid drinking contaminated water, Londoners quaffed alcoholic beverages of all proofs and flavors. They drank beer with breakfast, perhaps following a dram of sherry as an eye-opener, more beer as the morning progressed, perhaps interspersed with brandy to ward off the English chills, ale with lunch, raisin or elder wine with afternoon tea, which was a relative novelty and the principal alternative to alcoholic beverages, with the boiling of the water serving to kill the microorganisms that infested the water supply. Grape wine with dinner, followed by punch and liqueurs of one sort or another, white and wormwood, ratafia, nectar and ambrosia, rosolio, till bedtime. Not surprisingly, public intoxication was common. "We continued drinking like horses, as the vulgar phrase is," wrote one diarist, "and singing till many of us were very drunk. And then we went to dancing and pulling of wigs, caps, and hats, and thus we continued in this frantic manner, behaving more like mad people than they that profess the name of Christians. Whether this is inconsistent to the wise saying of Solomon, let anyone judge. Wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, and he that is deceived thereby is not wise." Often the sots found their way to the theater, where they behaved no better. Crowded into the galleries and the pit, they made ribald jokes at the expense of the actors, and purchasing apples and oranges from the barker women strolling the aisles between acts, hurled the fruit onto the stage. Alexander Pope, who was busy editing Shakespeare during Franklin's London stay, decried the presence of the rabble. "The many-headed monster of the pit, a senseless, worthless, and unhonored crowd, who, to disturb their betters mighty proud, clattering their sticks before 10 lines are spoke, call for the farce, the bear, and the black joke." Franklin frequented the theater and London's various other diversions, initially in the company of James Ralph. In his own words, he "spent with Ralph a good deal of my earnings in going to plays and other places of amusement." The velveted prostitutes were beyond his means, but he evidently engaged in what he afterward characterized vaguely as foolish intrigues with low women. Even this characterization struck him on second thought as too concrete. Having written it in the first draft of his autobiography, he proceeded to cross it out. That it referred specifically to prostitutes may be gleaned from the rest of the deleted description of his encounters with these low women, which from the expense were rather more prejudicial to me than to them. If he visited the bear-baiting dens, it was probably as an onlooker rather than a player. Neither then nor later did he manifest a gambling streak. As curious as the next person, he certainly saw prisoners in the pillory and convicts swinging from the scaffold. He retained all his fingers, a fact that attested either to his diffidence in the public pot or his dexterity. The English affinity for alcohol he encountered on the streets, in the theaters, and especially in the workplace. Upon discovering the emptiness of Governor Keith's promises, Franklin sought employment in the printing trade. Because London supported far more printers than all the American colonies together, there was no lack of work, and he soon accepted an offer from a man named Palmer, who had a shop in Bartholomew's Close. There he remained for nearly a year, making a strong and favorable impression on his employer. Yet Palmer was unable to provide Franklin sufficient opportunity for advancement, and he left to take up with another printer, one who did a larger business. This second house employed more than 50 men, allowing the proprietor, one Watts, to practice the sort of specialization that would be one hallmark of the Industrial Revolution about to begin. Certain men specialized in press work, others in composing, still others in collating, binding, and so on. Franklin's skills were sufficiently obvious that he had his choice of specialties. He initially chose the press room as a means of getting the physical exercise he was accustomed to as an everyday aspect of the work of print shop employees in the less diversified colonial trade. Partly on account of his youth, partly because of his well-muscled shoulders and back, partly because he sought out the heavy lifting where others did just the opposite, Franklin soon gained a reputation for strength. He typically carried two sets of heavy lead type, one in each hand, running up and down the stairs of Watts's shop, where the other pressmen carried one at a time. Making this feat all the more remarkable in English eyes was that the young American accomplished it without the fortifying aid of the beer the others considered essential to their work. Franklin's partner at the press drank a pint of beer before breakfast, a pint with breakfast, a pint at mid-morning, a pint with the midday meal, a pint in the afternoon, and a pint at day's end. Franklin later described this as a detestable custom.
Whether or not... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.